Thank you guys for coming once again to our weekly Dead Sea Scroll Bible study. We try to meet once a week, and we talk for about 2 hours, sometimes a little bit more, sometimes a little less. And we usually, the setup we do is we have people ask questions about any topic that's on their mind about the scriptures, and they'll answer those things. But on other times, we have a very specific curriculum, in a sense, of where we pick a book we want to study, or we pick a topic we want to study, and that's going to be what the focus we do for the teaching. This week, we're going to be doing a focus on a specific book we've been studying. We've been studying through it for the last 3 weeks now, and this week we're going to be finishing up our study. And that is a book called The Testaments of the 12 Patriarchs. Now, a testament in the context for this book is referring to the last words or the dying words imparted to the children as a final message for them before they end their days. And so these are, like in Jacob in Genesis, he gave his final words to his children. And they were blessings, prophecies. It's that type of idea. The basic idea is that when you approach death, very often you might have a sense of prophecy or a special insight on life. As you're approaching death, it's an amazing thing what death does to you. It inspires you, empowers you, or it motivates you to do something good before you die. So that's what these testaments are about. And these are the testaments of the 12 patriarchs. The 12 patriarchs are the 12 sons of Jacob. So we've got Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. And Jacob had 12 sons, and his 12 sons wrote their own testaments, their own wills. It's basically a will in a sense, but it's not quite the same thing as a will, because, you know, the will talks about your inheritance, who you divide it to, but that's not what these are. These are just a message to the family. And we look at Genesis and we see, where did Moses get all this information from? All the information about the patriarchs. And when the Dead Sea Scrolls were found, it was basically proven to us that Moses got the information from Genesis from all these other books that were written by the patriarchs. He had the Book of Enoch, the Book of Noah, Book of Abraham, Book of Jacob. And then there's these testaments. And all these writings Moses had in his collection, he was using them, consulting them, so he could write a narrative for us to help give us an overview of the history of the righteous men and the righteous faith. And most of these books were found in the Dead Sea Scrolls. Not all of them, but like Book of Jacob was not found. But we found a Book of Noah, we found a Book of Abraham, the Book of Enoch, and the Testaments, we found those. And so what we see is these writings before Moses' time. They were written before Moses. Okay, awesome. Sean's with us. So the writings of Moses were not the first writings. A lot of people say that, you know, the law is the beginning of scripture, but in reality, there's so much more. There's so many more writings before Moses was even born, and before the Law of Moses came. Book of Jubilees, that was written before the Law of Moses, in Moses' lifetime. Moses wrote that right before he wrote the rest of the Law, too. So we see there's a lot of literature prior, and the Dead Sea Scrolls is a testimony to a version of Judaism, or a version of the faith of the scriptures, which focuses as its foundation on the scriptures, the faith that came before Moses. The patriarchs, that's the foundation of our faith. And we see that how many of these writings were in the Dead Sea Scrolls that were found that came prior to Genesis. A lot of scholars will tell you that these writings are fakes, forged by random Jews for some random reason. I don't believe that's the case. The Dead Sea Scroll writers definitely did not believe that's the case. The Book of Jubilees quotes these writings and tells us that they wrote writings. Jubilees says, and then Noah wrote it in a book. Abraham wrote it in a book. Jacob wrote it in a book. Enoch wrote a book. And we found the Dead Sea Scrolls books of each of the one that Jubilees tells us that they wrote. So we know that Jubilees, the author of Jubilees, wasn't just making it up. He had those books and knew that those he believed those books were valid and authoritative. So there's a lot more to say about that idea of forgery is ridiculous because there's just so much against that idea. It doesn't make sense to forge these writings. But you'll see as we go through and study them, they're so powerful, prophetic of the Messiah, of Israel, the future, and they have very powerful lessons about sin and righteousness. And so that's what we're going to be going through now. So let's see here. We are, let me just get, I'm pulling up the page. The Testaments, the 12 patriarchs. Okay, we are gonna start with, I think this time it's gonna be Zebulun. Testament of Zebulun. Okay, so the Testament of Zebulun begins like all the other ones, telling us this is the copy of the words. It says this is the copy of the words of Zebulun, which he enjoined on his sons before he died. In the 114th year of his life, 2 years after the death of Joseph. All throughout these testaments, you see how old they were when they made these testaments, how old they were when they died, sometimes in relation to when Joseph died. So we see here, according to this, the testament here, is that he died, Zebulun died, 2 years after the death of Joseph. Or at the very least, he's giving these words to his children 2 years after. So he says, I, Zebulun, was born a good gift to my parents. For when I was born, my father was increased very exceedingly, both in flocks and herds, when with the straked rods he had his portion. He's basically saying, in Genesis, there's that story of how Jacob used the special rods to influence the offspring of his flocks, what they would look like. And he used that to be blessed so that he could have many more flocks than Laban. And Zebulun is connecting his own birth with that event. So he's saying he was born during that time. And he was... he feels that he was a blessing, or he was named Zebulun during that time, reflecting his good fortune that he had. Now, Zebulun says something interesting, which contradicts a lot of what, you know, regular Christians will tell you, or even Messianic sometimes, many others. He says, I am not conscious that I have sinned all my days except in thought. So now he's not saying that he never sinned. Some, I believe, as I've discussed in other teachings, I believe there are some people who have never sinned all their days. Zebulun is not saying he's never sinned, but in this case he says, I'm not aware that I have ever sinned my entire life, except in my thoughts. Then he says, nor yet do I remember that I have done any iniquity, except the sin of ignorance, which I committed against Joseph. For I covenanted with my brethren not to tell my father what had been done. Now, we're going to see something here that shifts the perspective on what Genesis says. Because the way Genesis says it, it makes it sound like all Joseph's brothers were in on it and wanted to kill Joseph. But there's something in Genesis which tells us that's actually not quite true. We've got Judah, who didn't want him to die, and made sure he was sold rather than being killed. And then we've got Reuben. He left, and when he came back and found out he had been sold, he was very upset with his brothers. So even though Genesis says Joseph's brothers wanted to kill him, it doesn't mean that they all wanted to kill him. That's an important distinction. Because in the Testaments, we're seeing that many of the brothers did not desire this to happen, but they were forced into it by some of the brothers who were really wicked and wanted to kill Joseph. In the other testaments we discussed, there was one of Simeon. He really wanted to kill Joseph. And we're going to see later tonight, other testaments, there were some others in the family who wanted to kill Joseph, and that was Dan and Gad. Those three were the ones who were most livid and hateful towards Joseph. And so, but Zebulun says, "But I wept in secret many days on account of Joseph, for I feared my brethren, because they had all agreed that if anyone should declare the secret, he should be slain." So they basically made an oath. The brothers who were very wicked, they basically forced everyone else to make an oath saying, if anyone tells about this, then they shall die. They shall be killed. And they agreed to that oath. So he was weeping because he regretted this oath that he made. And he was weeping for what had happened to Joseph, his brother. I mean, that's his own brother, and he was very torn about it. He says, "When they wished to kill him, I adjured them much with tears not to be guilty of his sin. For Simeon and Gad came against Joseph to kill him. And he said unto them with tears," Joseph said unto them with tears, "Pity me, my brethren, have mercy upon the bowels of Jacob, our father. Lay not upon me your hands to shed innocent blood, for I have not sinned against you. And if indeed I have sinned, with chastening, chastise me, my brethren, but lay not upon me your hand for the sake of Jacob our father." And as he spoke these words, wailing as he did so, I was unable to bear his lamentations and began to weep. And my liver was poured out, and all the substance of my bowels was loosened. Remember, in the other weeks we discussed how the scriptures actually tell us that our organs are very much a part of our emotions. So we see here that his liver, his bowels, it's all involved in his very deep grief that he's having. And one other thing I need to say before I continue is that these testaments, as I discussed in the other teachings, are a shortened version of the original text. Basically, when the Dead Sea Scrolls were found, these writings, fragments of these writings were found, but they were found in a much longer form. So basically, what this proves to us is that the original version of the testaments were much longer than the copies that we have. So sadly, someone took the full original text and shortened it to a summary or condensed version. And that's exactly what happened with the Law of Moses in the book of Deuteronomy, as I've said before. The original version was like twice the size as our copies today. But someone shortened the Law of Moses, the book of Deuteronomy, to its current version. And just like that, this happened with other books too. It's not an isolated incident. We've seen this happen with other books. So for the Testaments as well, the Testaments of the 12 Patriarchs, it was shortened from its full original text. So we can trust what these Testaments say, but we just have to know that the wording is not the original wording. The wording was much lengthier, much more archaic language, but this was made by a scribe who wanted to preserve the spirit of the full original text, but by making it a much shorter version so that people could read through it and preserve it easier, because scribes had to write it out by hand, and the full original text of this was really long, so it would have been really hard to preserve this book for people who were not so sure it's scripture. So they made a shorter version, and now people would be more willing to read it, preserve it, for future generations. And that's probably one of the only reasons we have these testaments still, is because someone decided these are such an important thing, but they're so long, and because of its length, people are not translating it, sharing it with people, so we're going to make a shorter version so that at the very least people have the basic gist of these writings. So that's very good that they did that. I just wish we had the full original, but we will eventually find the full original, if not in this lifetime, in the kingdom. If we make it to the kingdom, I believe we will figure out the full story. We can ask them ourselves. We can ask the 12 sons of Jacob, what happened? Can you tell us what was actually written in your testaments? And they can explain to us. So I'll continue with what I was saying. Zebulun says, and I wept with Joseph, and my heart sounded, and the joints of my body trembled, and I was not able to stand. And when Joseph saw me weeping with him, and them coming against him to slay him, he fled behind me, beseeching them. So Joseph, seeing that Zebulun is on Joseph's side, and that he doesn't want this to happen, Joseph runs over behind, hiding behind his shoulder, saying, "Protect me, Zebulun. Don't let them get me." Meanwhile, Reuben rose and said, "Come, my brethren, let us not slay him, but let us cast my let us cast him into one of these dry pits, which our fathers digged and found no water. And for this cause, the Lord forbade that water should rise up in them, in order that Joseph should be preserved." And they did so until they sold him to the Ishmaelites. So basically, we have here Reuben saying, "Look, these dry pits, there's no water in them. This must have been from God. This is a sign, and that we should be putting him there, not kill him. Let's put him in there, for this is the reason why water did not come when we wanted it to come here." So they agreed with him, and then eventually they ended up selling him, as we know from Genesis. Now Zebulun makes sure to tell us, he says, "In his price I had no share, my children." Remember, they sold him for money. He says, "Simeon and Gad and six others of our brethren took the price of Joseph and bought sandals for themselves and their wives and their children, saying, 'We will not eat of it, for it is the price of our brother's blood, but we will assuredly tread it underfoot, because he said that he would be king over us. And so let us see what will become of his dreams.'" So let's see who the brothers would be. So Simeon, Gad, let me do it another way. Let's see. Joseph and Benjamin obviously were not part of it, so that's down to 10. Zebulun's down to 9. And there's one other person that did not take part in the share. I'm not sure who that is. But so all the other brothers, after he was sold, participated in the... I think it probably was Issachar. Either Issachar or Levi. Other than that, I don't think it was anyone else. All of them had their own issues of sin in their life. But Issachar, as we know from the other study we did a few weeks ago, Issachar was a very righteous man throughout his life. And he was not aware of doing any sin, he said, just like Zebulun said. So it's very likely that it was Issachar who was not... who did not partake of the money that they got from selling Joseph. And now here's something interesting. They said, "We would not use it for food, but we would wear it as sandals." Because remember, the sandals represent uncleanness. For in the Law of Moses, we were told, your sandals must be removed when you're on holy ground. Moses was told that. And the Ethiopian church, they, to this day, they remove their sandals whenever they enter one of their churches because they believe it's holy ground. A church, in their view, is holy, and they consider that a command, that you're not supposed to have your sandals on when you walk into a church. It's kind of similar to what the Messiah said, how a man does not need his whole body to be washed all the time. Sometimes for hospitality, you wash the feet. And why? Because the feet is the dirtiest part of the body. The sweat and everything goes all the way down to your feet. The dirt on the ground, everything gets gathered there. And so when you're wearing sandals, it helps facilitate a gathering of dirtiness. So when you enter a holy place, you take off those sandals because now you're going to holy ground. The sons of Jacob, the brothers of Zebulun, who took part in the price of, they didn't want to eat it because they believed that would be wrong, immoral to do that. But they knew their feet were unclean, so they said, "We'll just wear it as shoes on our sandals." And in their mind, that was okay to do. Now here's a scribal addition, which may be authentic. Like, it may have been added by a scribe very long ago. Like, it may have been added by Moses, or it may have been added by one of the later men, like Solomon's time or Ezra. Who knows when this scribal edition was added? But it was not originally part of the Testaments that were written by Zebulun himself. It says, therefore it is written in the writing of the law of Moses, that whosoever will not raise up seed to his brother, his sandal should be unloosed, and they should spit into his face. And the brethren of Joseph wished not that their brother should live, and the Lord loosed from them the sandal which they wore against Joseph their brother. For when they came into Egypt, they were unloosed by the servants of Joseph outside the gate, and so they made obeisance to Joseph after the fashion of King Pharaoh. And not only did they make obeisance to him, but were spit upon also, falling down before him forthwith. And so they were put to shame before the Egyptians. For after this, the Egyptians heard all the evils that they had done to Joseph. So basically, what we see here is Zebulun's telling us that, in conjunction with the scribal edition, that this was written in the Law of Moses. Other manuscripts say Law of Enoch, but we know that's most likely not the correct reading, Law of Enoch. The Law of Moses tells us when the brother dies without children, his brothers are supposed to respect him. His closest relatives, who are able to marry his widowed wife, and to raise up children for their dead brother. That's in Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy says if the brother does not wish to do that, he must go through a special ceremony where he has to. Let me read it, actually, because it just kind of it connects with the passage. So one second while I load that. Let's see here. It should be in, I think, Deuteronomy 25. One second. Okay. I'm going to be reading from the New King James Version. So it says, here's from Deuteronomy 25. If brothers dwell together and one of them dies and has no son, the widow of the dead man shall not be married to a stranger outside the family. Her husband's brother shall go in to her to take her as his wife and perform the duty of a husband's brother to her. And it shall be the firstborn son which she bears will succeed to the name of his dead brother, that his name may not be blotted out of Israel. But if the man does not want to take his brother's wife, then let his brother's wife go up to the gate to the elders and say, my husband's brother refuses to raise up a name to his brother in Israel. He will not perform the duty of my husband's brother. Then the elders of his city shall call him and speak to him. But if he stands firm and says, I do not want to take her, then his brother's wife shall come to him in the presence of the elders, remove his sandal from his foot, spit in his face, and answer and say, so shall it be done to the man who will not build up his brother's house. And his name shall be called in Israel the house of him who has his sandal removed. So that was from Deuteronomy 25. And as I said, Zebulun, in his writing to us, Zebulun the son of Jacob, he tells us that this custom originated from what happened to Joseph. They after they sold Joseph, they used that money to buy sandals, and then when they went into Egypt, the Egyptians caused them to remove their sandals after they found out what they had done to Joseph, and they spit in their faces because they betrayed Joseph. And that's exactly right here. What we see in Deuteronomy is if you don't give seed to your brother, then you're betraying your brother. You're going against him. And it's a symbol. So that's an amazing thing. We see the origination of this law of Moses comes from this story of Joseph. Now I continue. Oh, and also remember the Pharisees in the New Testament, after they had purchased they had sold to Judas to betray the Messiah. They could not put it into the temple treasury because it was impure. Same kind of reasoning here. So they said, okay, we can't do that, but let's use it for to purchase a piece of land for Judas. So they did that. It's a similar idea here. His brother said, okay, we can't eat this because that would be unholy, unrighteous to do that. But let's use it to buy some sandals. So now, Zebulun says, and after he was sold, my brother sat down to eat and drink. So basically, they acted like nothing was wrong. They said, okay, he's sold now. Let's try to get over it. Let's have some food. Come on, let's eat. But Zebulun says, I, through pity for Joseph, did not eat, but watched the pit, since Judah feared lest Simeon, Dan, and Gad should rush off and slay him. But when they saw that I did not eat, they set me to watch him till he was sold to the Ishmaelites. And when Reuben came and heard that while he was away, he had been sold, he rent his garments, mourning, and said, how shall I look on the face of my father Jacob? So maybe it was Reuben who did not share in the price. I'm not sure. Because Reuben came after. So Reuben says, Zebulun says about Reuben, he took the money and ran after the merchants, but as he failed to find them, he returned grieving. So he was going to try to undo that and say, no, this is my brother, give him back. He couldn't find them. And Zebulun tells us, the merchants had left the broad road and marched through the troglodytes by a shortcut. In the original Hebrew, it was not troglodytes. That's a Greek translation. I'm not sure what the original would have been. But so then Zebulun says, Reuben was grieved and ate no food that day. Dan, therefore, came to him and said, weep not, neither grieve, for we have found what we can say to our father Jacob. Let us slay a kid of the goats and dip in it the coat of Joseph, and let us send it to Jacob, saying, no, is this the coat of thy son? And they did so, for they stripped off from Joseph his coat when they were selling him, and put upon him the garment of a slave. That's how his coat was removed, because they wanted to make him look like a slave. If he had that special multicolored coat, they would know, okay, that's obviously not a slave. A slave would not be dressed so elegantly and royally, so they had to change his garments. It says, Simeon took the coat and would not give it up, for he wished to rend it with his sword, as he was angry that Joseph lived and that he had not slain him. As I said before, Simeon, as we know from his testament that we studied the other a few weeks ago, he really wanted to kill Joseph. He was angry that he had not been able to kill him. And he had the coat in his hand, and he was like, no, I don't want you to do this. I want to be able to destroy this coat, because this is a symbol of Jacob's love for Joseph, and I despise that, and I want to eradicate it from the earth. It was his way of almost killing his brother. He couldn't kill his brother, so the next best thing would be to kill the coat, destroy that coat. But his brother said, no, we're not going to let you need to give it to us. So here's what happened. Zebulun says, we all rose up and said unto him, if thou givest not up the coat, we will say to our father that thou alone didst this evil thing in Israel. So basically they said, if you don't give it to us, we're going to put every one of us is going to blame this on you. And imagine if you have 8 brothers agreeing in testimony, he did it, it was him. That's going to sound very, it's going to be very hard to believe that these 8 would lie about that. So Simeon knew, okay, Jacob's going to believe them over me. So, and I did take a part of it. So they wouldn't technically be lying by saying he did it. So Simeon said, okay, fine, take it. You can do your plan. I'm not going to destroy the coat like I want to. But he was furious about it. So he gave it up. And they did as Dan had suggested. And Zebulun says, Now, my children, I bid you to keep the commands of the Lord, and to show mercy to your neighbors, and to have compassion towards all, not towards men only, but also towards beasts. So not you are to have compassion on all life, not just humans, but towards everyone, towards animals, towards the creatures of the earth. This is a very important lesson that's many people are not following because they think, well, it says in Genesis that we were given dominion over the animals so we can do whatever we want to them. We can abuse them, we can do all sorts of things. It's not a big deal, but no, it is a big deal. The law tells us we are to have compassion, and Zebulun here tells us too. And now Zebulun says, for this thing's sake, the Lord blessed me, and when all my brethren were sick, I escaped without sickness, for the Lord knoweth the purposes of each. So he basically said, because he was so compassionate towards everyone, he was not sick when his brothers were sick. Many times his brothers would get sick, but he wasn't. Zebulun was spared from that. This gives us a lesson. Tells us if we are very compassionate and obeying the commandments of God and showing mercy to our neighbors, then we will be blessed with very little sickness. So Zebulun exhorts his children, he says, to have compassion in your hearts as well. And then he says, for the sons of my brethren were sickening and were dying on account of Joseph, because they showed not mercy in their hearts. But my sons were preserved without sickness, as ye know. So basically, as we discussed before, the sins of the forefathers passed down from the generations for three generations. So his brothers had sickness, and their children had sickness too, because that sin was affecting the entire family through influence. When you're so much around when you're spending a lot of time around a sinful person, you are influenced negatively by their sinful energy that comes out of their bodies. There's an actual energy or essence. Sin isn't it's not in matter, but basically when someone sins, it gives off a negative, unhealthy energy. And those who are around it will get negatively impacted by it if they stay around it too much. And so Zebulun's brothers were negatively harming the health of their own families because of what they had done to Joseph, as Zebulun here tells us. Now Zebulun says, and when I was in the land of Canaan by the seacoast, I made a catch of fish for Jacob my father. And when many were choked in the sea, I continued unhurt. Hold on a second. I need to find my book version of the Testaments. It's right here. One second. Let me open the page. Because there's an important thing I wanted to tell you guys about Zebulun's passage, and I think I came to it. But it's not marked in the one I'm reading from. So let's find that page quickly. Let's see here. Okay, it is most of chapter 6 and most of chapter 7 and most of chapter 8 are not in most manuscripts of the Testaments, but they're in a few manuscripts, and I believe it's an error on the part of the scribes, so it was incorrectly removed. So I'm going to read the full text of what a few of the manuscripts say. So he's talking about, Zebulun was talking about catching fish for his father. He says, I was the first to make a boat to sail upon the sea, for the Lord gave me understanding and wisdom therein. And I let down a rudder behind it, and I stretched a sail upon another upright piece of wood in the midst. And I sailed therein along the shores, catching fish for the house of my father until we came to Egypt. And through compassion I shared my catch with every stranger. And if a man were a stranger or sick or aged I boiled the fish and dressed them well and offered them to all men as every man had need, grieving with and having compassion upon them. Wherefore also the Lord satisfied me with abundance of fish when catching fish, for he that shareth with his neighbor receiveth manifold more than the Lord from the Lord. For 5 years I caught fish and gave thereof to every man whom I saw, and sufficed to all the house of my father. And in the summer I caught fish, and in the winter I kept sheep with my brethren. Now I will declare unto you what I did. I saw a man in distress through nakedness in winter time, and had compassion upon him, and stole away a garment secretly from my father's house, and gave it to him who was in distress. Do ye therefore, my children, from that which God bestoweth upon you, show compassion and mercy without hesitation to all men, and give to every man with a good heart. And if ye have not the wherewithal to give to him that needeth, have compassion for him in bowels of mercy. I know that my hand found not the wherewithal to give to him that needed, and I walked with him weeping for 7 furlongs, and my bowels yearned towards him in compassion. Have therefore yourselves also, my children, compassion towards every man with mercy, that the Lord may also have compassion and mercy upon you. Because also in the last days God will send his compassion on the earth, and wheresoever he findeth bowels of mercy, he dwelleth in him. For in the degree in which a man hath compassion upon his neighbors, in the same degree hath the Lord also upon him. And when we went down into Egypt, Joseph bore no malice against us. To whom, taking heed, do ye also, my children, approve yourselves without malice, and love one another, and do not set down an account, each one of you, evil against his brother. For this breaketh unity, and divideth all kindred, and troubleth the soul, and weareth away the countenance. So let me stop there for a second. Let me tell you the let me read the shorter version. As I said, most manuscripts are missing most of that. So the shorter version says, "And I was the first to make a boat to sail upon the sea, for the Lord gave me understanding. And I let down a rudder behind it, and I stretched a sail upon another upright piece of wood in the midst, and I sailed therein along the shores, catching fish for the house of my father until we came to Egypt. For 5 years I caught fish, and in the summer I caught fish, and in the winter I kept sheep with my brethren. And when we went down into Egypt, Joseph bore no malice against us." And then the rest finishes. So all the rest of that was missing. So basically, what we learn from here is that there's some really great information about Zebulun's life, his own personal life, and how it was very much an important part of his life to have compassion and show mercy on people. He took of the poor, the needy, those who were sick, the stranger, and he's an example for us of how we are to approach everyone. We are to give them food, we are to clothe them, and to help them as they need. Show compassion on the people. Just because they might not be of your same faith, you can still have compassion on them. These are people who need help. The disciples, they said, "Do you want us to bring down fire to destroy the Samaritans?" And he said, "You do not know what spirit you are. I came to save men, not to kill them." And so that's the basic thing right here. You know, he's going throughout Egypt helping people. And, you know, the Egyptians worshipped other gods, but he still was helping Egyptians. And he says, it's an interesting thing because it kind of tells us that sometimes it's okay to steal. The translation of steal, in our modern language, almost implies it's a sin always. But I believe the law indicates to us, and common sense indicates to us, that there are some instances where stealing is acceptable. For instance, if someone was to tell you, if you're living somewhere and for miles around, like thousands of miles around, no food is available to you, and all the stores refuse to sell you food. They're saying, "Sorry, we're not going to sell it to the likes of you." Maybe it's a racist country. They say, "Sorry, you're black. We're not going to sell our food to you." Well, first of all, we need to understand that all the things of the world are only given to us on loan. They're our possessions only by a loan. We're borrowing them from our creator. If we cross a certain line of cruelty and we do not make it so that people can partake of things, then it is permissible for those people to steal, because it's not technically stealing anymore, because they don't have a right to that stuff anymore. The law tells us that if you're walking through someone's land, you can just pluck a fruit and eat it. You don't need permission. The law doesn't tell us we need permission. It just says when you're walking through somewhere, feel free to pluck fruit from someone's land. It tells us, don't pluck so much fruit that you have to put it into a basket, because now you're stealing. The law says, now you're stealing because you didn't need that much. You could just eat what you need in a single meal. And that's okay according to the law. But not harvesting it for yourself, because then it's just too much. And similarly, if you if let's say you're homeless and you can't live anywhere. Well, now basically you're trespassing wherever you go. On there's some places which say the homeless people cannot be in the public. And then homeless people can't be on other people's property either. Well, fact is, animals go on the private property and they're not stealing, so it doesn't make sense. So we're seeing that we need to think through God's eyes logically, and we shouldn't think through man's limits that they make up. A lot of their limits are just arbitrary. So yes, we should not be stealing, but when they cross a certain line, it's no longer their right to have it anymore. So there's many other examples that I can, if people are still confused about it, I can help explain. But so basically, I'm not trying to encourage any of you guys to steal. If you have the ability to purchase something, and you don't, and you just steal it, then that's wrong. If you have a job right now, and you go to the food store and you take something from the store without paying for the food, that's not okay, because you weren't forced to do that. You're not in a desperate situation. You're not in an emergency. Only if it's an emergency would something like that be okay. And so yeah, I'll move on from that topic. But that's a topic that's hard for some people to accept, but for others, they understand the reasons I said are valid. Now, and then the other thing I thought was pretty interesting that I read through, it said, he said, show compassion to all men because, he will have compassion upon you to the same degree. That's very similar to what the Messiah said. Show, if you do not have mercy on others, you will not be shown mercy. And to the measure you judge others, you will also be judged. So there's a lot of similar ideas, language, and concepts here. And then we also saw that Zebulun told us, he said, when I was on not I wasn't able to help someone. So what did I do? He says, I walked with him, weeping for 7 furlongs. It kind of reminds me of when the Messiah says, if someone compels you to go 1 mile, go with him 2 miles. That type of thing. That's what it reminds me of. So Zebulun's message to us, that's his, it's so important to him, is the compassion. And he tells us God's going to send compassion later on. That's a prophecy of the Messiah in the last days. He'll send us compassion. So he continues and says, let's see, Zebulun continues saying, he says, observe therefore the waters, and know when they flow together, they sweep along stones, trees, earth, and other things. But if they are divided into many streams, the earth swalloweth them up, and they become of no account. So shall ye be also if you be divided. Be not ye therefore divided into two heads, for everything which the Lord made hath but one head, and two shoulders, two hands, two feet, but all the and all the remaining members. He's basically saying, there's you need to be united, because if you're divided over things, you're not going to be successful. So he tells us to look at water. That reminds us of how Enoch speaks. He says, Enoch tells us, look at this, look at that, look at this part of nature. Behold this. He's telling us, look at nature and learn lessons from nature. Zebulun's copying and saying the same thing. And Zebulun also says, hold on one second. I'm just checking to see if there's a difference in the manuscript here. What verse am I at? 9:5. Let's see here. Okay, it's not in this one. Basically, in other of the testaments, most of the testaments speak of Enoch's writings. They actually had Enoch's writings and appealed to it. Some of the manuscripts say Enoch and others don't sometimes. So I was checking to see if it mentioned Enoch's writing, but he doesn't say it here. Right, so he says, I have learnt in the writing of my fathers that ye shall be divided in Israel, and ye shall follow two kings, and shall work every abomination. And your enemies shall lead you captive, and ye shall be evil entreated among the Gentiles, and with many infirmities and tribulations. And after these things ye shall remember the Lord and repent. And we're reading from Testament of Zebulun, the prophecies of Zebulun, the son of Jacob. He says, after these things ye shall remember the Lord and repent, and he shall have mercy upon you, for he is merciful and compassionate, and he setteth not down in account evil against the sons of men, because they are flesh and are deceived through their own wicked deeds. And after these things shall there arise unto you the Lord himself, the light of righteousness, and ye shall return unto your own land, and ye shall see him in Jerusalem for his name's sake. And again, through the wickedness of your works shall ye provoke him to anger, and ye shall be cast away by him unto the time of consummation. So that was a prophecy of the Messiah coming, of the first exile, the second exile, and so we have some amazing prophecy there. And he says, my children, grieve not that I am dying, nor be cast down in that I am coming to my end. For I shall rise again in the midst of you, as a ruler in the midst of his sons, and I shall rejoice in the midst of my tribe, as many as shall keep the law of the Lord, and the commandments of Zebulun their father. But upon the ungodly shall the Lord bring eternal fire, and destroy them throughout all generations. But I am now hastening away to my rest, as did also my fathers. But do ye fear the Lord your God with all your strength all the days of your life. And when he had said these things, he fell asleep at a good old age, and his sons laid him in a wooden coffin. And afterwards they carried him up and buried him in Hebron with his fathers. So let me see. Yeah, we need unity. Sean speaks of unity is what we need now. And the only way we can have that is if we have a central foundation, which we all agree to. And I think the Dead Sea Scrolls are the key to that. Once we establish that, then everything else falls into place. Now just to tell you, of the testaments of the 12 patriarchs, only the testaments of Naphtali and Levi were found, and they were found in fragments. But the fact is, since Levi's testament was found and Naphtali's, we have to assume the rest were there too. It's just the problem is with the Dead Sea Scrolls, fragments are found and the rest of it is missing. Like, for example, with 1st and 2nd Chronicles, all that was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls of 1st and 2nd Chronicles is a tiny little fragment about this size. The rest of it's gone. Scholars are not even 100% certain that it is 2nd Chronicles, because it's so tiny. So we're missing 1st and 2nd Chronicles from the Dead Sea Scrolls. But we know they had it. They had to have had it, because they were Jews. They were Israelites. Of course they had Chronicles, but for some reason, it wasn't found there. For the same thing with the testaments, there was Testament of Levi and Naphtali, which were found in fragments, but the rest of the testaments are missing due to the decay of time. Now, Zebulun's testament is over. We're going to proceed to the next testament, and that's Dan's testament. Dan, this is, in his last days, he spoke to his children in the 125th year of his life. He says, I have proved in my heart and in my whole life that truth with just dealing is good and well-pleasing to God, and that lying and anger are evil, because they teach man all wickedness. I confess, therefore, this day to you, my children, that in my heart I resolved on the death of Joseph, my brother, the true and good man. And I rejoiced that he was sold, because his father loved him more than us. For the spirit of jealousy and vainglory said to me, thou thyself also art his son. So we're seeing, giving us much more detail from the children's perspective. Genesis doesn't really give us much information about that. It just tells us that they were jealous, but it doesn't give us their own words about it. So that's what's so valuable about these testaments. They tell the story in their own words from their own perspective and add so many details. He says, so he wanted Joseph dead. But he says he was a true and good man, but I was opposing him. And he said it was a spirit of jealousy that came into him. So it's telling us that there's spirits of sin that can enter us. As Reuben said, remember, Reuben told us the seven spirits of sin and the seven spirits of the constitution of man. And Dan continues and says, one of the spirits of Belial, or Belial, the New Testament mentions Belial once in Paul's letters, and Belial is also mentioned in the Dead Sea Scrolls. That's one of the foundational figures. It's basically another name for Satan. And he said, one of the spirits of Belial stirred me up, saying, take this sword, and with it slay Joseph. So shall thy father love thee when he is dead. Sean speaks of, he was convinced about in his own life and in the past, he's had evil spirits compelling him to do different things, it seems. And now, continuing with Dan's words, he tells us, now this was the spirit of anger that persuaded me to crush Joseph as a leopard crusheth a kid, or a lamb. But the God of my fathers did not suffer him to fall into my hands, so that I should find him alone and slay him, and cause a second tribe to be destroyed in Israel. When he says second tribe, he's saying he did not allow Joseph to be found by him, because if Joseph had been killed, not only would Joseph's tribe be destroyed, but he would also destroy his own tribe. His tribe would be completely, it would be ruined, it would be cursed. So God prevented this from happening so that he wouldn't commit such a great evil and doom his descendants to have a negative sin in their bloodline. The sin does not pass down, but the negative consequences of it. Sickness, disease can pass down through the tribe and prevent them from having blessings. And this perhaps could be, Revelation doesn't say the Testament of Dan. That could be a scribal error, or that could also be very significant in saying that this is linked to Dan's words right here. The second tribe could be destroyed because of their sins, and they're no longer allowed to be part of that blessing of Revelation. But we do know in the law that Daniel will always have a part in the temple service and in the land of Israel. So, now Dan continues and says, my children, behold, I am dying, and I tell you of a truth, that unless you keep yourselves from the spirit of lying and of anger, and love truth and long-suffering, ye shall perish. For anger is blindness, and doth not suffer one to see the face of any man with truth. For though it be a father or a mother, he behaveth towards them as enemies. Though it be a brother, he knoweth him not. Though it be a prophet of the Lord, he disobeyeth him. Though a righteous man, he regardeth him not. Though a friend, he doth not acknowledge him. It's basically saying, anger leads you into major sins, and it causes you to not love the person you should be loving. It should be natural to want to love someone who's righteous and someone who's your family member. But when anger gets a hold over you and you can't, you let it so much have a grip of your life that you start doing things almost without control, then you suddenly will do irrational things. You will be angry by people who are righteous or who are loving, trying to love you, and you get angry at them. So anger, spirit of anger, is one of the worst things you can ever have. And it is really unhealthy and causes you to have less life. That's what some of the other scriptures state as well. For the spirit of anger, he says, encompasseth him with the net of deceit, and blindeth his eyes, and through lying darkeneth his mind, and giveth him its own peculiar vision. And wherewith encompasseth his eyes? With hatred of heart, and so as to be envious to his of his brother. Anger is an evil thing, my children, for it troubleth even the soul itself, and the body of the angry man it maketh its own, and over his soul it getteth the mastery, and it bestoweth upon the body power that it may work all iniquity. And when the body doeth all these things, the soul justifieth what it is done, since it seeth not aright. Basically, anger will corrupt your entire body and pollute it all and distort it so that it leads your whole body astray. And it leads your soul astray too. He says, therefore he who is wrathful, if he be a mighty man, hath a threefold power in his anger. One by the help of his servants, a second by his wealth, whereby he persuadeth and overcometh wrongfully, and thirdly, having his own natural power, he worketh thereby the evil. So someone who's wrathful, if he doesn't have power or wealth, it prevents him from doing a lot of evil. But if he has the power and wealth, he could be so wicked and so evil and do a lot of sin to people. So you want to watch out for people in power who are very angry and who have a lot of money. Those are the people who are dangerous, very dangerous. He says, though the wrathful man be weak, yet hath he a power twofold of that which is by nature. For wrath ever abideth such in lawlessness. So basically, it kind of reminds me of adrenaline. When I've heard stories of, like, when someone's trapped under a car or something, a woman, an older woman, or just, you know, a weak woman, can lift up that car. Now, I cannot lift up a car, people. But a woman who is older or, you know, who doesn't exercise can lift up a car because of that adrenaline going through her. Similarly, we're seeing here that someone who's angry and wrathful, even if they're weak normally, it doubles their power. That adrenaline comes in. You're so angry, and you can do things that normally you cannot do. I've heard stories of people who think they are demonic or who think someone else is demonic. I think my one friend said he threw someone across the room, and they flew across the room in a way that seemed unnatural. It seemed like demonic almost. And so there's things like that where you have a much stronger power when you're angry. Sorry, my mouth hurts for some reason. Hopefully I can continue without it being too much of a problem. Let's see here. He says, this spirit goeth always with lying at the right hand of Satan, that with cruelty and lying his works may be wrought. Let me get a drink of water for a second. Maybe that'll help. Okay. Yeah. I'll try not to talk so loud, maybe that's why. So continuing with Dan's testament, he says, the power of wrath, understand that it is vain. So he continues and goes through and explains all the bad stuff about anger, how I'll go through it. I was trying to see if I could skip through some of it, but I'll read it just in case. He says, first of all, it giveth provocation by word, then by deeds it strengtheth him who is angry, and with sharp losses disturbeth his mind, and so stirreth up with great wrath his soul. Therefore, when any one speaketh against you, be not ye moved to anger, and if any man praiseth you as holy men, be not uplifted. Be not moved either to delight or to disgust. For first it pleaseth the hearing, and so maketh the mind keen to perceive the grounds for provocation. And then being enraged, he thinketh that he is justly angry. If ye fall into any loss or ruin, my children, be not afflicted, for this very spirit maketh desire that which is perishable, in order that he may be enraged through the affliction. And if ye suffer loss voluntarily or involuntarily, be not vexed, for from vexation ariseth wrath with lying. So he tells us, don't be vexed when something bad happens to you, you lose something. Just, you know, as other scriptures say, like Job, he says, the Lord gives and the Lord takes away. And then there's other passages too, which speak of, don't make a bigger deal out of it than you need to. And everything that happens is part of God's plan. Even if it's something bad, there's an ultimate end goal in mind. So just remember, if something horrible happens to you, it can be turned into good later on in life. But it's up to you to turn it into good and use it for your advantage and to help others. Let's see. I want to make sure what I said that you guys understand, because as I was reading it, I was kind of having a blank for a second. So I want to make sure. Let's see here. Is it provocation by word? You know, when someone's speaking to you, we know some people who get so angry when someone's talking to them, like saying, like smart mouthing them, blah, 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 blah. And then the people get really angry when someone's insulting them. You don't have to get really angry. You just say whatever. It doesn't matter what they say. What matters is what God says. And then remember, the New Testament says, bless those who curse you, pray for those who persecute you, and it says, when others do bad things to you or say bad things about you, rejoice, because you will have reward for that. So don't make it a big deal. Just when someone says something horrible about you, you can be offended, but don't get angry over it and full of wrath and you just feel like you want to kill them or something. Don't think like that. Just say, okay, whatever. It's not a big deal. They're sinning. I was offended, but I'm going to get rewards for this if I do righteous and don't react in a negative way. And it's an opportunity to pray. Exactly, Sean. So, and he says, when someone praises you as a holy man, do not be so full of yourself and so like entitled. It's like an entitlement. When you start thinking you're entitled, then if something that you don't get it, then you're going to be angry. So don't be too proud of yourself that when someone's giving you compliments, they're complimenting you and saying you're so amazing, whatever. Say thanks, but don't let it get to your head. That's what he's telling us. And then he continues and says, moreover, a twofold mischief is wrath with lying. They assist one another in order to disturb the heart. And when the soul is continually disturbed, the Lord departeth from it, and Belial ruleth over it. So he's saying lying and wrath come together and they assist each other. So if you're an angry man, you better not be lying, because if you are, you're in some major trouble, because it's a perfect harmony of sin, which can lead to much greater sins. If you're angry but you're not a liar, then there is still some goodness in you, and that you can, there's a much greater chance of you coming out of that anger. But if you have lying, it's mixed with that anger, it's really gonna bring you down and make it almost impossible to change. Then Dan continues and says, observe therefore, my children, the commandments of the Lord, and keep his law. Depart from wrath and hate lying, that the Lord may dwell among you, and Belial may flee from you. Yeah, so the fruits of their life will be obvious. If you pursue the teachings and scriptures, you will be seen as righteous, and you will have fruits of the Spirit. Pure fruit. Now, what we're seeing here, Zebulun's telling us that we need to depart from wrath and lying, because if we don't, then Belial is going to send evil spirits to possess us. And that's exactly what the Shepherd of Hermas tells us, is that wrath and lying cause us to have evil spirits possessing us. And so we want to avoid that. The Holy Spirit cannot dwell with us if we have wrath and lying in our hearts. We need to get rid of that, purify our hearts of that sin. he says, speak truth each one with his neighbor. So shall ye not fall into wrath and confusion. But ye shall be in peace, having the God of peace, so shall no war prevail over you. Love the Lord through all your life, and one another with a true heart. I know that in the last days ye shall depart from the Lord. Ye shall provoke Levi unto anger, and fight against Judah. But ye shall not prevail against them, for an angel of the Lord shall guide them both, for by them shall Israel stand. And whensoever ye depart from the Lord, ye shall walk in all evil, and work the abominations of the Gentiles, going a whoring after women of the lawless ones, while with all wickedness the spirits of wickedness work in you. For I have read in the book of Enoch, the righteous, that your prince is Satan, and that all the spirits of wickedness and pride will conspire to attend constantly on the sons of Levi, to cause them to sin before the Lord. And my sons will draw near to Levi and sin with them in all things, and the sons of Judah will be covetous, plundering other men's goods like lions. Therefore shall ye be led away with them into captivity, and there shall ye receive all the plagues of Egypt, and all the evils of the Gentiles. And so when ye return to the Lord, ye shall obtain mercy, and he shall bring you into his sanctuary, and he shall give you peace. And there shall arise unto you, from the tribe of Judah and of Levi, the salvation of the Lord, and he shall make war against Belial, and execute an everlasting vengeance on our enemies. In the captivity shall he take from Belial the souls of the saints, and turn disobedient hearts unto the Lord, and give to them that call upon him eternal peace. And the saints shall rest in Eden, and in the new Jerusalem will the righteous rejoice, and it shall be unto the glory of God forever. And no longer shall Jerusalem endure desolation, nor Israel be led captive. For the Lord shall be in the midst of it, living amongst men. And the Holy One of Israel shall reign over it in humility and poverty, and he who believeth on him shall reign amongst men in truth. So that's a major prophecy of the future. And we see it was fulfilled, or it's still, and it's going to be fulfilled. He prophesied of the Messiah. He prophesied of the exile. And it confirms things in the law of Moses, like the curses, the plagues of Egypt will come upon you once you're in amongst the Gentiles. That's from the curses of the law in Deuteronomy 28, I think it is. So we're seeing so many connections here. And when he speaks about Levi and Judah, that will be from the salvation will come. That's the Messiah. He's going to come from the tribe of Judah and Levi. And he came. That's where he came from. And he fought against Satan. And so we see the prophecy of New Jerusalem and how everything's going to be everything's going to be restored to its righteousness in the final days. And let's see here. And he prophesied how Judah and Levi together are going to be the main ones. And that's what we see today. All the other tribes went into exile, but Judah and Levi, they stuck together. And he tells us the book of Enoch prophesied of these things. The book of Enoch that we have doesn't really give as much detail as this. As I've mentioned before, there were some other books found in the Dead Sea Scrolls by Enoch. So perhaps has everyone read something that we don't have from Enoch? But so some amazing prophecies right there. Continuing, he says, Dan says, now fear the Lord, my children, and beware of Satan and his spirits. Draw near unto God and to the angel that intercedeth for you. For he is a mediator between God and man. And for the peace of Israel, he shall stand up against the kingdom of the enemy. That's either the Messiah or Michael the archangel. But so that corresponds with what the language of the New Testament says, the mediator between God and man. And he says, therefore is the enemy eager to destroy all that call upon the Lord. For he knoweth that on the day on which Israel shall repent, the kingdom of the enemy shall be brought to an end. So that's why he's so much against Israel. Because he knows if they repent, then everything's going to come in place. The temple will be built. The kingdom will be ushered in. So Satan is trying to destroy Israel and to overcome it. That's how Israel is here today, but they're still not righteous because Satan is trying to keep Israel from coming back to the law, even though Israel has been restored into the land, the state of Israel. But not all the Israelites have returned either because Satan is trying to keep them in exile, as many as he can. Then Dan says, for the very angel of peace shall strengthen Israel, that it fall not into the extremity of evil. And it shall be in the time of the lawlessness of Israel that the Lord will depart from them. The translator adds not there. It's possible not should be there and was removed from manuscripts accidentally. So it says, the Lord will depart from them, but will transform them into a nation that doeth his will, for none of the angels will be equal unto him. And his name shall be in every place of Israel and among the Gentiles. Keep therefore yourselves, my children, from every evil work, and cast away wrath and all lying, and love truth and long suffering. And the things which ye have heard from your father, do ye also impart to your children, that the Savior of the Gentiles may receive you. For he is true and long-suffering, meek and lowly, and teacheth by his works the law of God. Depart, therefore, from all unrighteousness, and cleave unto the righteousness of God, and your race will be saved forever. And bury me near my fathers. And then it says they buried him after he died, and then And then it says, this was added by a scribe, but it says, nevertheless, Dan prophesied unto them that they should forget their God and should be alienated from the land of their inheritance and from the race of Israel and from the family of their seed. So we finished that one. Naphtali's testament we already did, so we're skipping that one. And now we're going, as I said, I'm going to try to finish the testaments in this one. We've already done a good chunk of the testaments already. We're getting close to the end now. So, I mean, we still got a ways to go, but we're getting close to the end of the book, so this is good. Now we're doing Gad's testament. Gad spoke to his sons in the 125th year of his life. He says, I was the ninth son born to Jacob, and I was valiant in keeping the flocks. Accordingly, I guarded at night the flock, and whenever the lion came, or the wolf, or any wild beast against the fold, I pursued it, and overtaking, I seized its foot with my hand and hurled it about a stone's throw, and so killed it. So he's saying he was a powerful man. He had strength. He says, now Joseph, my brother, was feeding the flock with us for upwards of 30 days, and being young, he fell sick by reason of the heat. He returned to Hebron to our father, who made him lie down near him, because he loved him greatly. And Joseph told our father that the sons of Zilpah and Bilhah were slaying the best of the flock and eating them against the judgment of Reuben and Judah. This is a fuller story that we don't get in Genesis, and the original version of this must have been much longer. So this is a very interesting extra story that we don't have in any other place. He says, Joseph told our father that the sons of Zilpah and Bilhah were slaying the best of the flock and eating them against the judgment of Reuben and Judah. For he saw that I had delivered a lamb out of the mouth of the bear and put the bear to death, but had slain the lamb, being grieved concerning it, that it could not live, and that we had eaten it. And regarding this matter, I was wroth with Joseph until the day that he was sold. Basically, he's saying that, he killed some of the animals because they were injured by others, and then they ate them. And they didn't like, Joseph didn't agree with that, and he reported it to Jacob. And so that angered Gad, because he was hurt by that he would, like, in a sense, he kind of viewed him like a tattletailing on him, you know, almost. And but instead of letting it go, he held a grudge against him. That was always at the back of his mind, how he did. I can't believe he did that. You know, he was, in Gad's mind, he didn't think what he was doing was wrong. But he was scolded by his father, rebuked, and said, how could you do this? You should not have done this. This was not right of you. So Gad was made to be like the bad one. Jacob was making him feel like he was really bad son. And Joseph was being all, Jacob was saying, good job, Joseph. You're a good son. Gad, he's a bad son. So he started getting jealous there, and he started getting angry with Joseph that he would do something like that, because he interpreted Joseph's intentions the wrong way. And so he was angry until Joseph was sold. He says, and the spirit of hatred was in me, and I wished not either to hear of Joseph with the ears or to see him with the eyes, because he rebuked us to our faces, saying that we were eating of the flock without Judah. for whatsoever things he told our father, he believed him. So Joseph also rebuked his brothers, like, to the face. And he was probably, when you rebuke someone, you don't just say nicely, you know, you shouldn't really do that. That's not how you rebuke someone. You say, what are you doing? That's not right. That's a sin. Stop doing that. That's evil. Stop it. It's a rebuke right there. And it's hard to deal with sometimes, because some people think they're in the right, and they get offended when someone's trying to correct them and say, you're in the wrong. Snap out of it, you stupid. You know, they think, okay, I'm offended by you saying that. So that's why we see he was so upset with Joseph. He says, I confess now my sin, my children, that oftentimes I wished to kill him because I hated him from my heart. Moreover, I hated him yet more for his dreams. So again, Genesis tells us about that. When he had the dreams, the brothers who hated him even more. It drove them really angry. He says, and I wished to lick him out of the land of the living, even as an ox licketh up the grass out of the field. And Judah sold him secretly to the Ishmaelites. And thus through covetousness we were bent on slaying him. Thus the God of our fathers delivered him from our hands, that we should not work great lawlessness in Israel. And now, my children, hearken to the words of truth, to work righteousness in all the law of the Most High, and go not astray through the spirit of hatred, for it is evil in all the doings of men. Whatsoever a man doeth, the hater abominateth him. And though a man worketh the law of the Lord, he praiseth him not. Though a man feareth the Lord, and taketh pleasure in that which is righteous, he loveth him not. He dispraiseth the truth. He envieth him that prospereth. He welcometh evil speaking. He loveth arrogance, for hatred blindeth his soul, as I also then looked on Joseph. So he's saying, you know, hate blinds you and distorts your understanding of people, and it turns you against the righteous. Just like what Dan was telling us. He says, beware, therefore, my children, of hatred. Now, hatred is different than anger. There's an important distinction there. Hate is you want nothing good for the person. Anger is not you don't want anything good for the person, but you're full of wrath. Like, you know, there's a different feeling there. They're closely connected, but they're not quite the same. Anger leads to hatred, and hatred can lead to anger as well. But you can hate someone without being angry. So that's an important distinction. He says, beware of hatred, my children, because it worketh lawlessness even against the Lord himself. For it will not hear the words of his commandments concerning the loving of one's neighbor, and it sinneth against God. So hatred causes you to avoid what God's telling you. That's what happened with Jonah. We were just talking about this on Facebook. Jonah hated the Ninevites. And so because of his hatred, he was not listening. He was not hearing the commandments of God. So he was working lawlessness even against God himself by not obeying the commandments of God to preach to the Ninevites. So again, it says, will not hear the words of his commandments concerning the loving of one's neighbor, and it sinneth against God. That's exactly what Jonah did. Continues and says, for if a brother stumble, it delighteth immediately to proclaim it to all men, and is urgent that he should be judged for it, and be punished, and be put to death. I often get this feeling and sense that people are very hateful towards people that are wicked, and we should not be like that. There is a certain amount of hate we are to have for the wicked, but not pure hate, not complete hate. In other words, you should still love them to some extent. And the way I've seen some people treat, for example, President Obama, I find that's not okay to do. Yes, he's an evil man, and he's done a lot of sins and bad things for the country, but at the same time, he is our president, and he is a fellow human being, and so we should not despise everything about him. He is doing some good things. We have no clue a lot about what some of the stuff he does, because a lot of it's secret for national security, and we can't know everything. So he might be doing a lot of good, and we don't realize. And we're so focused on hating this person, we're ignoring all the other good stuff he does, and we just want to put him down. So whenever something bad happens to Obama, we'll make fun of him, or if people will insult him if he does something silly or embarrasses himself. But we shouldn't be glad when something bad happens to someone. We shouldn't, you know, be trying to always be focusing on, ha, you got cancer, ha ha, you know, that type of thing. We want to be really careful about something like that. Or, you know, with John Kerry, I think it was John Kerry. Maybe it was Biden. It might have been Biden, actually. His relative, near relative, died. His son, I think it was. And so in that case, you know, we don't want to say to him, ha, your son died, serves you right. You know, that's what a spirit of hate will say. And there were probably people who were saying stuff on Facebook negative about him like that and how his son died and stuff. So we got to be really careful, and we want to make sure we're not purely hating people. Because remember, we are sinners too. Most of us have done some sins in our life, and some worse than others. And so we want to, you know, be careful. If we still have sin, then in some ways, perhaps we are wicked. And people, we don't want to be hated. We don't want to be treated badly. So do unto others as you would have them do unto you. That's kind of what Gad is telling us we should do, and telling us that he did not do. He was full of hate, and he was wrong to hate. He didn't have justified reasons for it. So when a brother stumbles, it delighteth that person who hates, and he wants to proclaim it to everybody on Facebook. Proclaim it to everybody on Facebook, or to, you know, to his friends and family. Ha, you know, look at that. And he's urgent that he should be judged for it and be punished and put to death. So you, if you hate someone, you're looking for them to die. That's what happened with the Pharisees. They wanted the Messiah to die. They were actively seeking, okay, let's see what we can get. Let's see what we can trap him in so that we can execute him. They were looking for an excuse to kill him because they wanted him dead. So they were looking for the smallest sin that he did, which could justify executing him. So they thought, you know, Sabbath is pretty easy to justify killing someone for doing something on it. It's pretty easy to find a way to frame them for something. So let's see if we can get him to catch him in breaking the Sabbath, and then we'll kill him. That was not a righteous way of looking at it. That's all they cared about was killing people and wanting the person they hate eliminated. Someone who's out of love does not want the person eliminated. He wants them converted so that they don't have to die. So Gad continues and says, if it be a servant, it stirs him up against his master, and with every affliction it is deviseth against him. If possible, he can be put to death. Sounds like it's saying the servant who hates his master might plot to kill his master, because how much he hates his master. That's to be avoided as well. Hatred, he says, worketh with envy also against them that prosper. So he says, Dan told us it was wrath and lying come together. Here we're seeing hatred and envy come together. He says, hatred worketh with envy also against them that prosper. So long as it heareth of our seeth their success, it always languisheth. For as love would quicken even the dead, which is kind of like a prophecy of resurrection right there, love would quicken even the dead and would call them back that are condemned to die. So hatred would slay the living, and those that had sinned venially, it would not suffer to live. For the spirit of hatred worketh together with Satan through hastiness of spirit in all things unto men's death. But the spirit of love worketh together with the law of God in longsuffering unto the salvation of men. Let me look up that one word just to make sure I understand it correctly. Venially. Yeah. Basically, what he just said there, someone who hates someone and wants them dead for a venial sin. The Catholic Church speaks about the venial sins and the worst sin, the mortal sin, the one that you should die for. Basically, he's not saying, you know, there's a sin unto death, as John says. John says, I do not say that you should pray. Let me find that. Because this is a very key importance here, is that Gad is not saying that people should not be given the death penalty for something they deserve. But he's talking about how hatred basically makes it so that person doesn't deserve it, and yet they you want them dead for it, for their sin that wasn't that big a deal. Let's see here. It's taking a while to load, so I'll just kind of go on, and maybe I'll read it back in a second. So he says, "Hatred, therefore, is evil, for it constantly mateth with lying, speaking against the truth." And now he's connecting it with lying as well. "And it maketh small things to be great, and causeth the light to be darkness, and calleth the sweet bitter, and teacheth slander, and kindleth wrath, and stirreth up war and violence, and all covetousness, and filleth the heart with evils and devilish poisons." I've seen this so many times where people are, I bet you guys know someone like this in your life before, who they are like, the tiniest little thing bugs the crap out of them. They're really pissed off and annoyed. They could be such a tiny thing, and they get really angry. I know some people like that. And I have some family members like that, who I'm not going to say who they are, but family members who, you know, some like a pot drops on the floor in the kitchen and makes a loud noise. "Why did you drop that?" You know, like, full of anger. It's really not that big a deal. But little things can set off people and make them angry. And so that's what we see. What Gad is telling us is a perfect reflection of our own experiences in our lifetime. But so here's the passage that I was trying to pull up. It's from 1 John. It says, "If anyone sees his brother sinning a sin which does not lead to death, he will ask, and he will give him life for those who commit sin not leading to death." There is sin leading to death. I do not say that he should pray about that. All unrighteousness is sin, and there is sin not leading to death. So basically he says, if someone deserves to die, they're on death row, don't pray that they're not going to be given the death penalty. They deserve the death penalty. Assuming they did the crime and deserve to die for that sin, because the law of Moses has, for this sin, like adultery, murder, they need to be killed as the punishment. So in this case, Gad tells us venial sins, sins that don't deserve death, the spirit of hatred drives you to want that person to die, even though they didn't do something that deserves death. Now, let's see here. Gad continues and says, "These things therefore I say to you from experience," so experience here, that's important, "my children, that ye may drive forth hatred which is of the devil, and cleave to the love of God. Righteousness casteth out hatred. Humility destroyeth envy." So if you want to stop being so envious of someone, humble yourself, have humility. "Cast out hatred, will seek righteousness. Then you will get rid of your hatred." He says, "For he that is just and humble is ashamed to do what is unjust, being reproved not of another, but of his own heart, because the Lord looketh on his inclination." So his conscience speaks against himself, and he doesn't do a horrible thing because he's reminding himself how bad that is to go against the law. "He speaketh not against a holy man, because the fear of God overcometh hatred." If someone's a holy man, the fear of God prevents you from hating that person. So fear of God is a way of getting rid of that hate. "So for fearing lest he should offend the Lord, he will not do wrong to any man, even in thought." So he said, okay, I want to have hateful thoughts towards this person, but I know that's wrong. I'm fearing God because I know if I hate this person in my heart, I'm murdering him in my heart. And I'll be condemned for that, so I got to stop doing that. I can't think that way anymore. That's what you got to do to prevent yourself from becoming a very hateful and sinful person. He says, "These things I learned at last, after I had repented concerning Joseph. For true repentance, after a godly sort, destroyeth." What sounds familiar, Sean? You said, "True repentance, after a godly sort, destroyeth ignorance, and driveth away the darkness. and enlighteneth the eyes, and giveth knowledge to the soul, and leadeth the mind to salvation. Now, I know somewhere in the New Testament it says something like true repentance after a godly sort, or something along those lines. Okay, so the longing of sin to be taken away sounds familiar, you said. Yep. Then he says, and those things which it hath not learnt from man, it knoweth through repentance. For God brought upon me a disease of the liver, because of his hatred. Hatred is linked to the liver, according to Gad. And had not the prayers of Jacob my father succored me, it had hardly failed, but my spirit had departed. So basically, his hate was negatively affecting his liver, and he would have died probably much younger had Jacob not prayed for him, and had he not repented of his hatred. So he says, for by what things a man transgresseth, by the same also is he punished. So it's sort of like, that's what Jubilee says. If you hurt someone with a, if you hit them with a stick, you should be hit by a stick and stuff like that. It says like a 2-lead degree that you do to them, it should be done to you. And so he said right here, for what things a man transgresseth, by the same also he is punished. And that's what the Apostle Peter shows us in the in his vision, Revelation, where he, a revelation of Peter, he sees the punishments of all the wicked, and they receive punishments corresponding to the sins that they did in their life. So women who commit abortion, they're in blood, and their babies are tormenting them. This is basically what you do to others, you will have come back to you. So he says, since therefore my liver was set mercilessly against Joseph, in my liver too I suffered mercilessly, and was judged for 11 months, for so long a time as I had been angry against Joseph. So we see it's to the degree. Now my children, I exhort you, love ye each one his brother, and put away hatred from your hearts. Love one another in deed and in word, and in the inclination of the soul. For in the presence of my father I spake peaceably to Joseph. And when I had gone out, the spirit of hatred darkened my mind, and stirred up my soul to slay him. So again, not just your deeds and your words, but also in your heart. Hate in your heart is a dangerous thing. It will lead to murder if you let it be unchecked. He says, love ye one another from the heart, and if a man sin against thee, speak peaceably to him, and in thy soul hold no guile, so don't hold grudges. If he repent and confess, forgive him. Ah, look right there. And if he repent and confess, forgive him. It does not say, forgive him even if he does not repent and confess. So you see, some people falsely teach, this is not the truth, some people falsely teach that you have to forgive everybody even if they don't repent and if they don't confess their sin. That's a lie. That's not the truth. But people are, they're made to feel guilty and that they're sinning because they're not forgiving someone. But in the gospel, it says the same thing. The gospel, in Gospel of Luke, says the same exact language. It says, if a man asks for forgiveness, forgive him. I forget what chapter it is, but it's right there in Gospel of Luke, and the people overlook it. But it's pretty clear that by the language of the gospel and what Gad here says, you don't forgive someone that does not deserve to be forgiven. They deserve forgiveness if they come to you and say, I'm sorry, and they try to change their life around and not live like that anymore. Yeah, you have to repent for forgiveness. Otherwise, why am I going to forgive you for something that's still a part of your heart, that you still like to do? Should I forgive a rapist who is still raping people? No. But at the same time, I'm not going to hate that person purely, solely. I still love that person who's raping people, but only a small amount. That person deserves some love, but the vast majority should be hatred because of how wicked that person is. David, in the Psalms, he says, I hate those who hate you, God, with a perfect hatred. David said that in the Psalms, a perfect hatred. So there's a perfect hatred and an imperfect hatred. The perfect hatred is the kind where you hate wickedness. So if you hate someone who's wicked, you want them to be righteous. Be righteous. Stop being wicked. Stop doing your horrible things. Someone who hates someone in a bad way doesn't care about them being converted. They just want them destroyed because they just hate them. Hate their guts. We should hate them for the bad stuff about them and love them for the good stuff about them. Everybody has some good stuff about them. There's always some value to everybody. Even Satan himself has some good, because why? Otherwise he wouldn't have been created. He wouldn't still be here. He would be sent away already. He's still here for a purpose. And I believe there are still some lessons for Satan to learn as well. And he'll come around, and it says every knee will bow. Every knee will confess that he is God and that they were in the wrong. It does not mean everyone's going to enter heaven, the kingdom of heaven, and have eternal life. It just means everyone's going to realize the truth, and they're going to submit to that truth. Even all the people who are condemned, they will know the truth, and they will change their hearts and will repent of their ways, but they will have to still suffer the eternal punishment for their sins. So let's see here, because even God loves the wicked. He says, do as God does, because even God shows mercy to sinners. He rains down rain for them and sunshine for them and all that. That's in the Gospels. So we see we have to follow his example. Then Gad continues and says, so remember, he says, if he repent and confess, forgive him. But if he deny it, do not get into a passion with him, lest catching the poison from thee, he takes the swearing, and so thou sin doubly. So he says, you know, if they're not going to repent, then don't confront him with passion, because you're going to make him even more angry and sin even more, and you're going to sin more. So just avoid it. If someone is not who's not seeking repentance and forgiveness, they're not seeking it, then just don't interact with them. It's better to avoid that. So then he says, let not another man hear thy secrets when engaged in legal strife, lest he come to hate thee and become thy enemy, and commit a great sin against thee. For oft times he addresseth thee guilefully, or busieth himself about thee with wicked intent. And though he deny it, and have yet a sense of shame when reproved, give over reproving him. For he who denieth may repent so as not to wrong thee again. Yea, he may also honor thee, and fear, and be at peace with thee. But if he be shameless and persisteth in his wrongdoing, even so, forgive him from the heart, and leave to God the avenging. So right there, that seems to contradict what I said earlier about how forgive the person if he repents. Right here he says, if he persisteth in his wrongdoing, even so forgive him from the heart and leave to God the avenging. As I said, the original text was much longer and it was condensed by a scribe. So that was the scribe's way of trying to summarize the original thought. It's basically saying don't hold a grudge against the person. You know, don't hold on to it. Just say, okay, you know what? I hope eventually this guy's going to turn around, and I want him to turn around. I want the best for him, and I want him to be saved. In that sense, you forgive him. You don't forgive him for, you know, he doesn't deserve to be embraced and fellowshiped with when he's still in that sin. You don't have to have him in a part of your life when he doesn't deserve to be a part of your life. Leave to God the avenging. Don't take a vengeance on yourself, okay? That's what we see in the scriptures as well. We're not to take the law into our own hands. The judges are to do that, and God himself will set everything right on Judgment Day. Now, right, you don't hang someone if they deserve it. It's not your right, not your place to kill that person. God will give you justice on Judgment Day. He says, God continues and says, if a man prosper more than you, do not be vexed, but pray also for him that he may have perfect prosperity, for so it is expedient for you. And if he be further exalted, be not envious of him, remembering that all flesh shall die, and offer praise to God who giveth things good and profitable to all men. Seek out the judgments of the Lord, and thy mind will rest and be at peace. And though a man become rich by evil means, even as Esau, the brother of my father, be not jealous, but wait for the end of the Lord. For if he take away wealth gotten by evil means, he forgiveth him if he repent, but the unrepentant is reserved for eternal punishment. For the poor man, if free from envy, he pleaseth the Lord in all things, is blessed beyond all men, because he hath not the travail of vain men. Put away therefore jealousy from your souls, and love one another with uprightness of heart. Remember, the Messiah told us, your treasure should not be on earth, it should be in heaven. Treasure on earth is material wealth and stuff like that. Don't be jealous about that stuff. It's not important. It'll rot away. The moths will eat it. It doesn't matter. The true value is in the eternal realm that will come down to us in the next age, after the millennial kingdom. It'll be the blessings forever. That's what truly is valuable and matters. The money, it's not that big a deal. So don't be jealous because the evil are successful and prosperous. Because even though they have some good in their life, they have a lot of bad. And they're also going to have a lot of bad in the next life as well. And very little good. Whereas, even though you have a lot of bad in this life, even though you do have some good as well, you're going to have good in your next life and not bad. So just keep that in mind. The Gospel of Luke mentions that, how Lazarus... and the rich man. The rich man, the Messiah, Abraham actually said to him, you had your good things in your life, and now you have your bad things. And Lazarus, he had his bad things, and now he has his good things. That's the same example and principle that we're seeing here at work. Now, continuing with Gad, we're almost done with the Testament of Gad. He says, do ye also, therefore, tell these things to your children, that they honor Judah and Levi, for from them shall the Lord raise up salvation to Israel. Prophecy of the Messiah again. He says, for I know that at the last your children shall depart from him, and shall walk in all wickedness and affliction and corruption before the Lord. And when he had rested for a little while, he said again, my children, obey your father, and bury me near to my fathers. And then he died. And he says, after 5 years, they carried him up to Hebron and laid him with his fathers. So that's the end of Gad's testament. Let's see, what are the ones we have left? We have Asher and Benjamin. Those are the only ones left. Okay. So we'll go through Asher now. And they're both pretty short compared to the other ones. So we'll see here. Asher, he's speaking to his sons in the 125th year of his life. He says, he was still in health, but he said to them, hearken ye children of Asher to your father. I will declare to you all that is upright in the sight of God. Two ways hath God given to the sons of men, and two inclinations, and two kinds of action, and two modes, and two issues. Therefore all things are by twos, one over against the other, for there are two ways of good and evil, and within these are the two inclinations in our breasts, discriminating them. He's talking about the heart. Therefore, if the soul take pleasure in the good, all its actions are in righteousness. And if it sin, it straightway repenteth. For having its thoughts set upon righteousness and casting away wickedness, it straightway overcometh the evil and uprooteth the sin. But if it incline to the evil inclination, all its actions are in wickedness, and it driveth away the good, and cleaveth to the evil, and is ruled by Belial, even though it work what is good, he perverteth to evil. For whenever it beginneth to do good, he forceth the issue of the action into evil for him, seeing that the treasure of the inclination is filled with an evil spirit. I'll stop there for a second. This is an important passage to me, personally, because when I was having a very dark time about 5 years ago, I was having suicidal thoughts, and I was never seriously considering killing myself, but, you know, just thoughts in my head, and I was very, very much depressed. And I was looking for answers, I couldn't find them. And this was one of the passages, or the Testament of Asher. The teachings of the Testament of Asher were really significant to me and helped me not give up and to keep fighting, to keep looking for the answers, and to use a foundation to base morality and base truth upon. It was one of the key things that helped me figure some of the stuff out through philosophy. So it has a special place in my heart. And as I said in the other one, the Testament of Reuben, a passage from there also has a special place in my heart for that same reason. Both those two passages were very helpful for me to pointing me in the right direction to find the answers I was looking for in a really dark time in my life. And so Asher basically tells us here, he talks about how someone who's wicked, if there's something good, he just perverts it to evil. If he does something good, it's always with an evil intent, or he perverts it in a bad way. And the good man, if he makes some mistakes, he does error, or even sometimes he does a sin accidentally, didn't realize it was a sin, oh man, I just sinned. He immediately repenteth and then determines to never do it again. And he won't do it again because he's a righteous man. And so if he accidentally does a sin, he says, okay, I just sinned. I should not have done this. I won't go back to this again. The evil man, the bad stuff, he's really bad. And then the good stuff that happens in his life or that he does, he then perverts that into evil. Asher continues and says, a person then may with words help the good for the sake of the evil. Yet the issue of the action leadeth to mischief. There is a man who showeth no compassion upon him who serveth his turn in evil. And this thing hath two aspects, but the whole is evil. And there is a man that loveth him that worketh evil, because he would prefer even to die in evil for his sake. But concerning this, it is clear that he hath two aspects, but the whole is an evil work. Though indeed he have love, yet he is wicked, who concealeth what is evil for the sake of a good name, but the end of the action tendeth unto evil. And another stealeth, doeth unjustly, plundereth, defraudeth, and withal pitieth the poor. This too hath a twofold aspect, but the whole is evil. He who defraudeth his neighbor provoketh God, and sweareth falsely against the Most High, and yet pitieth the poor. The Lord who commandeth the law, he setteth at naught, and provoketh, and yet he refresheth the poor. He defileth the soul, and maketh gay the body. He killeth many, and pitieth a few. This too hath a twofold aspect, but the whole is evil. Another committeth adultery and fornication, and abstaineth from meats, and when he fasteth, he doeth evil, and by this power of his wealth overwhelmeth many, and notwithstanding his excessive wickedness, he doeth then commandments. This too hath a twofold aspect, but the whole is evil. Such men are hares, for they are half clean, but in very deed are unclean. For God in the tables of the commandments hath thus declared. So right there, he's talking some amazing stuff right there about how wickedness can have some good parts of it, but if it has even some sin parts about it, it makes the whole thing a sin. You know, if someone steals money from the rich to give it to the poor, that's a good intention. You're trying to do good, but you did sin to do it, so it makes the whole thing sinful. It's the same thing with breaking the Sabbath. If you're breaking the Sabbath in order to do something good, it was good that you were trying to do something good, but you broke the Sabbath. That's bad, so the whole thing's bad. It's not bad to heal someone, but if you break the Sabbath to heal someone, that's bad. Healing never breaks the Sabbath, but sometimes you might do something so you can heal someone. So, like, in other words, buying and selling is forbidden on the Sabbath. If you buy and sell medicine or a doctor to help heal someone, that's breaking the Sabbath. That's a sin. You're trying to heal them, that's a good thing, that's not a sin. But because you did both of them in that one action, it makes the whole thing evil, the whole bad. So we have to see from that perspective of, if when you're thinking about, is this a sinful thing or a good thing, think about the totalness of it. Is it good, the bad part? Does it have sinful parts about it? If it does, then you can't do it. Even though you might be able to justify it that it's some good, it does some good for people. No, because it's partially sinful, so don't do it. And he compares it to unclean animals. So we see that unclean animals already existed before Moses, and he already knew the principle of clean versus unclean. Noah was told that too. So we know that it's not true what people say that the unclean laws originated with Moses. It came before. Yeah, wow, backwards. Yeah. Now, let's see here. He says, "Do not ye, my children, wear two faces like unto them of goodness and of wickedness, but cleave unto goodness only, for God hath his habitation therein, and men desire it. But from wickedness flee away, destroying the inclination by your good works. For they that are double-faced serve not God, but their own lusts, so that they may please Belial and men like unto themselves." Now here's something interesting that you'll see as well, which expands upon it. Very important. It says, "For good men, even though they are of single face, though they be thought by them that are double-faced to sin, are just before God. For many in killing the wicked do two works, of good and evil. But the whole is good, because he hath uprooted and destroyed that which is evil. One man hateth the merciful and unjust man, and the man who committeth adultery and fasteth. This too has a twofold aspect, but the whole work is good, because he followeth the Lord's example, in that he accepteth not the he accepteth not the seeming good as the genuine good. Another desireth not to see a good day with them that riot, lest he defile his body and pollute his soul. This too is double-faced, but the whole is good. For such men are like to stags and to hinds, because in the manner of wild animals they seem to be unclean, but they are altogether clean, because they walk in zeal for the Lord, and abstain from what God also hateth and forbiddeth by his commandments, warding off the evil from the good." So I'll explain for a second what that means. These are clean animals, he just said, stags and hinds. Some of their mannerisms are similar to unclean animals, but they're really clean. According to the law's descriptions, they're clean. Now, the problem is, it seems like he's saying, it's okay if you do evil and good, it's as long the whole is good, it's okay. That's not what he's saying, though, because evil in Hebrew has a different meaning. It means negative, bad, and not everything bad or negative is a evil sin. So when he says, for example, when he says, killing the wicked, that's good and evil. The whole is good. Here's why. Killing someone is a evil, or it's a bad thing. It's a negative thing that's happening that you're doing, but it's righteous and good because you're eliminating the enemy according to the law of God, where the people who do certain sins deserve a death penalty, and the judges are to kill them who deserve to die. And in the same thing, when you're when you're fighting in war, if you're fighting a wicked army in war and they deserve to die in war, you kill them, you're killing the wicked, and it's a good thing. It's a good thing, even though you're killing them is bad. The act of killing is bad, but because it's for a good, the overall thing is good, and it's not a sinful thing. So it's bad, but it's not sinful. There's an important distinction there. So because it's not sinful, but it's only bad action, but it's for righteousness, it makes the entire thing good. Same thing when you're hating someone, you're hating a sin. You're hating a sinful person. Hate is a negative quality. It's a negative thing. Even God though hates people. David says he hates the wicked, those who do evil. And so God hates people, and we are supposed to hate the sinners and the wicked, but it is a righteous thing so long as the hate is a perfect hatred, and we love the good parts about them, and the hate is bad, but it's not evil, because they deserve to be hated. It's a righteous thing to hate that person. And so that's basically what Asher is saying there. And then Asher says, "You see, my children, that there are two in all things, one against the other, and the one is hidden by the other, in wealth, covetousness, in conviviality, drunkenness, in laughter, grief, in wedlock, profligacy. Death succeedeth to life, dishonor to glory, night to day, and darkness to light. And all things are under the day, just things under life, unjust things under death, wherefore also eternal life awaiteth death. Nor may it be said that truth is a lie, nor right wrong, for all truth is under the light, even as all things are under God. All these things, therefore, I proved in my life, and I wandered not from the truth of the Lord, and I searched out the commandments of the Most High, walking according to all my strength with singleness of face unto that which is good. So just so you know, a lot of people can get confused by this type of thing, because it sounds like he's saying at one time, you know, if you do something good and bad, it's still evil. If you do something good and bad, it can be good. And so when people read this, it gets confusing to them sometimes. But when you read it the proper way, that's what I told you earlier is what he's saying. There's two things in all things. There's good and bad in all things. But the goodness is, the total picture is what you're looking for. Is the picture honoring and respecting? Is it doing righteousness, the totality of it? Or is the totality of it unrighteous because there's sin involved? So the key is sin involved or is it not involved? If sin is not involved, even though it be good and bad, it's righteous. If sin is involved, even though it's good and bad, it is evil and sin, the totality of it. And Asher says, we're approaching the end now of Asher, and he says, take heed, therefore, ye also, my children, to the commandments of the Lord, following the truth with singleness of face, for they that are of double-faced are guilty of a twofold sin. For they both do the evil thing, and they have pleasure in them that do it, following the example of the spirits of deceit, and striving against mankind. Do ye therefore, my children, keep the law of the Lord, and give not heed unto evil as unto good, but look unto the thing that is really good, and keep it in all commandments of the Lord, having your conversation therein, and resting therein. So we rest in the commandments of God, and rest in goodness and righteousness. Don't converse about bad, wicked things. Don't be so, like, don't watch impure TV shows that are like comedy, you know, impure comedy and stuff like that. That make crude and disgusting jokes. You know, don't converse about that. Avoid that and think on pure and noble and good things. As Paul says, whatever is good, noble, pure, whatever he said, Philippians, think on those good things. He says, for the latter ends of men do show their righteousness when they meet the angels of the Lord and of Satan. For when the soul departeth troubled, it is tormented by the evil spirit, which also it served in lusts and evil works. But if he is peaceful with joy, he meeteth the angel of peace, and he leadeth him into eternal life. Become not, my children, as Sodom, which knew not the angels of the Lord, and perished forever. For I know that ye shall sin, and be delivered into the hands of your enemies. Here's a prophecy, okay? Into the hands of your enemies, and your land shall be made desolate, and your holy places destroyed, and ye shall be scattered unto the four corners of the earth, and ye shall be set at naught in the dispersion as useless water, until the Most High shall visit the earth, coming himself as man, with men eating and drinking, and breaking the head of the dragon in the water. He shall save Israel and all the Gentiles, God speaking in the person of man. Therefore do ye also, my children, tell these things to your children, that they disobey him not. For I have known that ye shall assuredly be disobedient, and assuredly act ungodly, not giving heed to the law of God, but to the commandments of men, being corrupted through wickedness. And therefore shall ye be scattered as Gad and Dan, my brethren, and ye shall know not your own lands, tribe, and tongue. So he's connecting Asher's tribe with Gad's and Dan's, which is, might be important in the last days for determining who are the people. I guess they're connected. Asher, Dan, and Gad, they're connected. But the Lord, he says, will gather you together in faith through his tender mercy and for the sake of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Excuse me. And then he dies after telling them to bury him. He died at a good old age, it says. So, now, that's all other testaments have been done. The final one is the Testament of Benjamin. So, that's we'll be going to that one. And then once I finish that, then I'm going to ask you guys a question of if you want me to do the fragmentary testaments in the Dead Sea Scrolls. We'll see how much time we have at that point, and if I'll ask you guys. So, Benjamin, he was 125 years old, and he says, as Isaac was born to Abraham in his old age, so also was I to Jacob. And since Rachel, my mother, died in giving me birth, I had no milk. Therefore I was suckled by Bilhah, her handmaid. For Rachel remained barren for 12 years after she had borne Joseph, and she prayed the Lord with fasting 12 days, and she conceived and bare me. For my father loved Rachel dearly and prayed that he might see two sons born from her. Therefore was I called Benjamin, that is, a son of days. I'll stop there for a second. Benjamin's name is falsely and incorrectly said by the Jews and Christians. Most people you've heard will tell you Benjamin means son of the right hand, son of the right. That's not what it means. It actually means son of days. According to Benjamin here, we're told that. And then in the Samaritan manuscripts of the Torah, I believe the Samaritan manuscripts, they're in Hebrew, are more reliable usually than the Masoretic text. Not all the time, but most of the time. But sometimes these scribes update the language because there's archaic language, so they update it to their own language. The Samaritans stopped using a special plural. In Hebrew, there's an ancient plural that's in Aramaic. Like, all right, Elohim in Hebrew. I don't think there's a version of this in Aramaic, but if there was, it would be Elohim with an I-N, or let's say for kings. Okay, kings, Melakim in Hebrew, Aramaic, Melakin with an N. In ancient Hebrew, there was the im ending, but there was also that Aramaic ending, in, I-N. And so, the Samaritans, not using the in ending anymore, they updated Benjamin's name, and they said, instead of Benjamin, they changed it to Benjamim, I-M. So in their copies of the Torah, it's spelled with a mem instead of a nun, Benjamim. But that's incorrect spelling. That was them updating it, because they understood, they knew correctly that this was not son of the right hand, it was son of days. And that's what Benjamin tells us. So son of days it means. Because day in Hebrew is yom or yam, plural, yomim. But in this case, it's the ancient plural, yin, so yomin, son, ben, yomin, days, of days. So that's why he was named that. Then he says, when I went into Egypt to Joseph, and my brother recognized me, he said unto me, what did they tell my father when they sold me? And I said unto him, they dabbled thy coat with blood and sent it, and said, know whether this be thy son's coat? And he said unto me, even so, brother, when they had stripped me of my coat, they gave me to the Ishmaelites, and they gave me a loin cloth, and scourged me, and bade me run. And as for one of them that had beaten me with a rod, a lion met him and slew him. And so his associates were affrighted. Now, let me just read one thing of that. In my book, the Testament of Benjamin has a variant reading there in some manuscripts, which is very interesting, and I want to read it to you guys so that you have the full picture there. In some manuscripts, we actually see Arminian manuscripts. It says, and Joseph said unto me, even so, brother, the Canaanite merchants stole me by force. And it came to pass that as they went on their way, they concealed my garment as though a wild beast had met me and slain me. And so his associates sold me to the Ishmaelites, and they did not lie in saying this, for he wished to conceal from me the deeds of my brethren. And he called to him his brethren and said, do not tell my father what ye have done unto me, but tell him as I have told Benjamin, and let the thoughts among you be such, and let not these things come to the heart of my father. So originally Joseph wanted his brothers not to talk about it. Don't tell Jacob what happened, because if you tell him, he's going to be really heartbroken that you guys did this. Just tell them it, because it's technically true what you guys said. You didn't lie, so just, it's okay. Don't worry about it. In other words, everything's fine now. The damage is done. We're healed. Everything's fine. Jacob still doesn't know about this. Don't tell him, because it's just going to bring up bad stuff that's already over. It's a good advice where basically, if something happened long ago and it's in the past, don't bring it up again to someone who didn't even know about it, because it's unnecessarily causing them damage when you don't really need to. It's a good advice for us. And then, so Benjamin continues, he says, Do ye also, therefore, my children, love the Lord God of heaven and earth, and keep his commandments, following the example of the good and holy man Joseph. And let your mind be unto good, even as ye know me. For he that hath his mind right seeth all things rightly. Fear ye the Lord, and love your neighbor. And even though the spirits of Belial claim you to afflict you with every evil, yet shall they not have dominion over you, even as they had not over Joseph my brother. Just like with Job, the spirits of Belial had dominion over him. Because he was loving and righteous, they afflicted him, but they did not have dominion over him. Okay, I correct myself there. So that's what we know. If we love and are righteous, spirits of Belial, they can afflict us, but they can't have dominion over us. Now he says, how many men wished to slay him, talking about Joseph, and God shielded him. For he that feareth God and loveth his neighbor cannot be smitten by the spirit of Belial, being shielded by the fear of God. Nor can he be ruled over by the device of men or beasts, for he that is helped by the Lord through the love which he hath towards his neighbor, he is helped. For Joseph also besought our father that he would pray for his brethren, that the Lord would not impute to them as sin whatever evil they had done unto him. And thus Jacob cried out, my good child, thou hast prevailed over the bowels of thy father Jacob. And he embraced him and kissed him for 2 hours, saying, in thee shall be fulfilled the prophecy of heaven concerning the Lamb of God and Savior of the world, that a blameless one shall be delivered up for lawless men, and a sinless shall die for ungodly men in the blood of the covenant for the salvation of the Gentiles and of Israel, and shall destroy Belial and his servants. So right there, Jacob was prophesying to Joseph. So we see a lot of prophecy here about, in this book of the Testaments, prophecy of the Messiah. Amazing prophecies. He continues and says, see ye therefore, my children, the end of the good man. Be followers of his compassion, therefore, with a good mind, that ye also may wear crowns of glory. For the good man hath not a dark eye, for he showeth mercy to all men, even though they be sinners. So once again, you don't hate them, even though you hate them for the evil parts, but you love them for the good parts. So you show mercy to them, even though they're sinners. Though they devise with evil intent concerning him, by doing good he overcometh evil, being shielded by God, and he loveth the righteous as his own soul. If anyone is glorified, he envieth him not. If anyone is enriched, he is not jealous. If anyone is valiant, he praiseth him. The virtuous man he laudeth. On the poor man he hath mercy. On the weak he hath compassion, unto God he singeth praises. And him that hath the grace of a good spirit he loveth as his own soul. If therefore ye also have a good mind, then will both wicked men be at peace with you, and the profligate will reverence you and turn unto good, and the covetous will not only cease from their inordinate desire, but even give the objects of their covetousness to them that are afflicted. So when you are clinging to righteousness, and you have full of grace and love for others, others are going to be affected by that. And even though they might hate you at first, they'll realize they're in the wrong, and they'll change. It's not a guarantee that everyone will, but it's a general rule that people are going to be attracted to what you have because you are a very pleasant person to be around, a very loving and kind person. Only the ones who are so full of hate and evil will not be turned and like you for who you are. He says, if you do well, even the unclean spirits will flee from you, and the beast will dread you. For where there is reverence for good works and light in the mind, even darkness fleeth away from him. So a wicked man, even though he doesn't like you, he's going to try to get away from you, because he doesn't want you around him. For if anyone doeth violence to a holy man, he repenteth. For the holy man is merciful to his reviler, and holdeth his peace. So remember, if someone horribly wicked does bad to someone and harms them, his conscience is going and it's going to tell him, why did you do that? That was really wrong that you did that. He was such a patient and holy man, and look what you did to him. So even if they commit horrible acts of sin against you, it'll come back to them, and they'll be repenting of it in their hearts. And then, if anyone betrayeth a righteous man, the righteous man prayeth. Though for a little he be humbled, yet not long after he appeareth far more glorious, as was Joseph my brother. So you might lose a lot of what you have. You might be betrayed, but in the end, you will become even more glorious. Just like with Job. Job lost so much, but he was faithful. He was humbled for a little, but he appeared even more glorious. And the same thing with Joseph. He said, now Benjamin continues and says, the inclination of the good man is not in the power of the deceit of the spirit of Belial, for the angel of peace guideth his soul. And he gazeth not passionately upon corruptible things, nor gathereth together riches through a desire of pleasure. He delighteth not in pleasure, he grieveth not his neighbor. He sateth not himself with luxuries, he erreth not in the uplifting of the eyes. For the Lord is his portion. The good inclination receiveth not glory nor dishonor from men, and it knoweth not any guile or lie or fighting or reviling. For the Lord dwelleth in him and lighteth up his soul, and he rejoiceth towards all men always. The good man hath not two tongues of blessing and of cursing. Remember James was talking about this? You can't have two coming out from the same mouth. The good mind does not have the two tongues of blessing and of cursing, of contumely and of honor, of sorrow and of joy, of quietness and of confusion, of hypocrisy and of truth, of poverty and of wealth, but it hath one disposition, uncorrupt and pure, concerning all men. It hath no double sight, no double hearing, for in everything which he doeth or speaketh or seeth, he knoweth that the Lord looketh on his soul. So he knows everything he does, God sees it, so he has to be righteous. He cleanseth his mind that he be not condemned by men as well as by God. And in like manner, the works of Belial are twofold, and there is no singleness in them. Therefore, my children, I tell you, flee the malice of Belial, for he giveth a sword to them that obey him. And the sword is the mother of seven evils. First, the mind conceiveth through Belial. And first, there is bloodshed. Secondly, ruin. Thirdly, tribulation. Fourthly, exile. Fifthly, dearth. Sixthly, panic. Seventhly, destruction. Therefore was Cain also delivered over to seven vengeances by God. For in every 100 years the Lord brought one plague upon him. And when he was 200 years old, he began to suffer. In the 900th year, he was destroyed. For on account of Abel his brother, with all the evils was he judged, but Lamech was with 70 times 7. Because forever those who are like unto Cain in envy and hatred of brethren shall be punished with the same judgment. But that's a significant passage because it tells us that Benjamin knew the story of Cain and he had some extra information about it. Now, I suspect that some of that extra information is slightly incorrect because it's not 100% reconcilable with Jubilees. And I know numbers are the first thing to go in manuscripts and scribal errors are numbers. So I think slight of those details for like the numbers might be off a little bit. Or it might refer to, when it says 200 years, when he was 200 years old, he began to suffer, and every 100 years he was suffering, it may be that the 900th year is the 900th year from creation, not the 900th year of Cain's life. Because according to Jubilees, Cain did not live to 900 years old. So that's how I would reconcile it. Now, Benjamin continues and says, we're getting close to the end here. He says, do ye, my children, flee evil doing, envy and hatred of brethren, and cleave to goodness and love. He that hath a pure mind in love looketh not after a woman with a view to fornication, for he hath no defilement in his heart, because the Spirit of God resteth upon him. This is similar to what the Messiah said. But the Messiah said, if you look on a woman, you commit adultery. Here he says fornication, and that's important because it doesn't make sense if you look on a single woman and you're single that you're committing adultery with her in your heart. It's fornication in your heart. So when you look with a woman with a view of fornication, you have an image in your mind, you're lusting after her. It's not adultery in your heart, but it's fornication in your heart, and it's wickedness and defiling. But the man who is pure in his heart, who is righteous, he does not do that. He says, for as the sun is not defiled by shining on dung and mire, but rather drieth up both and driveth away the evil smell, so also the pure mind, though encompassed by the defilements of earth, rather cleanseth and is not itself defiled. It's interesting because scripture like that, it tells us lessons about nature, how the sun purifies the unclean things. And then now Benjamin says, and I believe that there will be also evil doings among you, from the words of Enoch the righteous. So he's quoting from Enoch again. He says, that ye shall commit fornication with the fornication of Sodom, and shall perish, all save a few, and shall renew wanton deeds with woman. And the kingdom of the Lord shall not be among you, for straightway he shall take it away. Nevertheless, the temple of God shall be in your portion, and the last shall be more glorious than the first. And the 12 tribes shall be gathered together there, and all the Gentiles until the Most High shall send forth his salvation in the visitation of an only begotten prophet. And he shall enter into the first temple, and there shall the Lord be treated with outrage, and he shall be lifted up upon a tree. And the veil of the temple shall be rent, and the Spirit of God shall pass onto the Gentiles as fire poured forth. And he shall ascend from Sheol, and shall pass from earth into heaven. And I know how lowly he shall be upon earth, and how glorious in heaven. So it's a prophecy of the Messiah here from Benjamin. He's also mentioned, as I said, Sean, you got out for a second, he was quoting from Enoch, he knew from Enoch. He says he read from Enoch about the evil doings that his tribe would do. So now it says the first temple, and that seems like an error because, you know, the second temple was built. But I do know that the scriptures refer to the second temple as the Temple of Solomon. So in that sense, it's still the first temple. It's rebuilt. The prophecy is that he would be killed in the first temple, the Messiah. He'd come from the Most High. He would be the only begotten prophet. So prophecy of the Messiah and the prophecy of the tribes of Israel being scattered and then gathered again. Now, Benjamin then says, now when Joseph was in Egypt, I longed to see his figure and the form of his countenance. And through the prayers of Jacob, my father, I saw him while awake in the daytime, even his entire figure exactly as he was. And when he said these things, he said unto them, know ye therefore, my children, I am dying. Well, I'll stop there for a second. So we see that Benjamin actually was given a blessing of seeing what his brother Joseph still looked like. And he knew, okay, Joseph, my brother, is still alive. So when they all went into Egypt to get grain for their family, Benjamin saw Joseph and knew that was Joseph. He didn't say anything. He kept quiet about it. So that's an extra detail that we don't realize from Scripture. But this is more explanation about it. It helps us to give greater context to the story of Genesis. He says, do ye therefore truth, each one to his neighbor, and keep the law of the Lord and his commandments. For these things do I leave you instead of inheritance. Do ye also therefore give them to your children for an everlasting possession, for so did both Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. For all these things they gave us for an inheritance, saying, keep the commandments of God until the Lord shall reveal his salvation to all Gentiles. And then shall ye see Enoch, Noah, and Shem, and Abraham and Isaac and Jacob rising on the right hand in gladness. Then also we shall rise, each one over our tribe, worshipping the King of heaven, who appeared upon earth in the form of a man in humility. And as many as believe on him on the earth shall rejoice with him. Then also all men shall rise, some unto glory and some unto shame, and the Lord shall judge Israel first for their unrighteousness. For when he appeared as God in the flesh to deliver them, they believed him not. And then shall he judge all the Gentiles, and many as believed him not when he appeared upon earth. And he shall convict Israel through the chosen ones of the Gentiles, even as he reproved Esau through the Midianites, who deceived their brethren, so that they fell into fornication and idolatry. And they were alienated from God, becoming therefore children in the portion of them that fear the Lord. If ye therefore, my children, walk in holiness according to the commandments of the Lord, ye shall again dwell securely with me, and all Israel shall be gathered unto the Lord. So that's a prophecy of the resurrection. Now, this is the final chapter, and I'm going to go to my book now because of this, because there's some differences. Let's see here. Hold on. Okay, so it says, and I shall no longer be called a ravening wolf on account of your ravages, but a worker of the Lord, distributing food to them that work what is good. And there shall arise in the latter days one beloved of the Lord, of the tribe of Judah and Levi. Again, a prophecy of the Messiah. A doer of his good pleasure in his mouth, with new knowledge enlightening the Gentiles. Unto the consummation of the age shall he be in the synagogues of the Gentiles, and among their rulers as a string of music in the mouth of all. And he shall be inscribed in the holy books, both his work and his word, and he shall be a chosen one of God forever. And through them he shall go to and fro as Jacob my father, saying, he shall fill up that which lacketh of thy tribe. So it's the prophecy of the Messiah and of the scriptures being written, the New Testament, the New Covenant. Hold on one second here. Let me see. Now, in other manuscripts, it's a prophecy of Paul, not of the Messiah. So it seems kind of strange why it would be a prophecy of Paul and not the Messiah. But I'm going to read it just in case it's the original. But most likely the case, the original was Levi and Judah. Perhaps there was two prophecies in it of Levi and Judah and Paul, but it's iffy. So here's what the other, many other manuscripts say. It says, and I shall no longer be called a ravening wolf on account of your ravages, but a worker of the Lord, distributing food to them that work what is good. And there shall rise up from my seed in the latter times one beloved of the Lord, hearing upon the earth his voice, and a doer of the good pleasure of his will, enlightening with new knowledge all the Gentiles, even the light of knowledge, bursting in upon Israel for salvation, and tearing away from them like a wolf, and giving to the synagogue of the Gentiles. And then it continues and says, until the consummation of the age shall he be in the synagogues of the Gentiles, and among their rulers as a strain of music in the mouth of all. He shall be inscribed in the holy books, both his work and his word, and he shall be a chosen one of God forever. And through them he shall go to and fro, as Jacob my father, saying, he shall fill up that which lacketh of thy tribe. And by the way, that last little thing, it's actually, when I was reading it from the site online, it conflates the two readings, but that longer reading of until the consummation of the age and the rest of that actually comes from the manuscripts which seem to speak about Paul. I gave you the two possible readings there. I'm not sure which is the correct one. Maybe both are somehow correct. And then let's see here. And then the book ends, and in some manuscripts it says, in the 91st year from the entrance of the children of Israel into Egypt, they and their brethren brought up the bones of their fathers secretly during the Canaanitish war, and they buried them in Hebron by the feet of their fathers. And they returned from the land of Canaan and dwelt in Egypt until the day of their departure from the land of Egypt. Obviously, that was not in the original version of Testament of Benjamin. So that's the Testaments. So now, let me see how long have we gone. 2 hours and 23 minutes. Do you want me to stop here, guys, or do you want me to read from the Dead Sea Scrolls two fragmentary testaments, so not a lot if it's preserved of it, fragmentary, of the testament of Moses' grandfather and Moses' father. They wrote stuff too. So should I say that for another time, or would you like to hear that as the conclusion of this study that we do? What about you other guys? Julie and I think Rhonda. Okay. So we got two or three witnesses is sufficient, according to the scriptures. So you'll read it. Let me just load the file though, shouldn't take long. We lost Sean. I'm not sure if he'll be back or not. So loading it now. So the grandfather. Can you guys still hear me? I froze for a second. Hopefully you guys can still hear me. It's loading right now. Okay, yeah, we're only going to do this for a few more minutes, because these are pretty short. Okay, you're back, Sean. Good. I asked the others if they wanted me to read these fragmentary testaments that were found, and we're going to do that. Because we had at least two or three witnesses, so we're going to do it. Now that you're the third witness. So, Moses' grandfather was named Kohath, okay? Kohath was the son of Levi. So, we are going to read Kohath's words here. Let me get to the passage. Hold on. Okay. So here we go. This was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls, only one copy of Moses' grandfather's final words. So it says in this one, it is one fragment that was found. There might have been a few other fragments, but this is the only one that they provide in this book. It says, "And God of gods for all the centuries or all the ages, and he will make his light shine upon you and make you know his great name, and you will know him, and you will know him because he is the God of the ages and the Lord of all works and the ruler of all, to deal with them according to his will. And he will make for you joy and gladness to your sons and the generations of truth forever. And now, my sons, be careful with the inheritance which has been transmitted to you, and which your fathers have given you, and do not give your inheritance to foreigners or your heritage to half-breed, so that you become humiliated and foolish in their eyes. For they will scorn you, because, being residents among you, they will become chiefs over you. Hold on to the word of Jacob, your father, and hold fast to the judgments of Abraham and to the righteous deeds of Levi and of me, and be holy and pure from all mingling, holding on to the truth and walking in uprightness, and not with a double heart, but with a pure heart and with a truthful and good spirit. And you will give me among you a good name and joy to Levi and gladness to Jacob and rejoicing to Isaac and honor to Abraham, because you have kept and carried on the inheritance which your fathers gave you, truth and justice and uprightness and perfection and purity and holiness and the priesthood, according to all that I have commanded you, and according to all that I have taught you in truth from now on and for all the ages." Some words missing there. So I'm just going to give a pause to let you know that some words are missing. So, "All the word of truth will come upon you. Eternal blessings will rest upon you and will remain for all the eternal generations, and there will be no more from your punishment, and you will rise to make judgment upon, and to see the sins of all the sinners of the world, in the fire, and in the abysses, and in all the caves, in order to, in the generations of justice, and all the sons of wickedness will vanish. And now to you, Amram, my son, I command, and to your sons, and to their sons, I command. And they have given to Levi, my father, and which Levi, my father, has given to me, all my writings as witness that you should take care of them. For you, in them is great worth, in their being carried on with you." And the fragment ends there. And there was two other fragments, actually, but they're not important to read. There's barely anything on them. We see there that Kohath was the son of Levi. He was the next in line of the priesthood. Levi was high priest. Then Kohath was the high priest. He received from Levi the writings, the scriptures. All the scriptures of their forefathers were handed to Levi, according to the Book of Jubilees. That's what we're told. And then we're told here in Kohath that Levi had given to him all the writings of scripture. And now Kohath is giving all the writings of scripture to Amram. So it's in the priesthood. The priesthood is to have the scriptures, the secret scriptures. And this is how we knew it was a testament of Kohath because it says, Amram, my son. And we know from the Bible that Amram's father was Kohath from the genealogy in Exodus. So he passes it on to Amram. There's much more to that testament that we're now completely lost. It's all gone. But we get a little taste of that testament. It's amazing. And now the testament of Amram. We have about 5 fragmentary copies of the Testament of Amram. Maybe a little bit less. 4 maybe. But otherwise we have about that many. And so I'm going to read some of these fragments here. He says, in one fragment, it says, copy of the writing of the words of the vision of Amram, son of Kohath, son of Levi, all that he revealed to his sons and what he advised them on the day of his death in the year 136, the year of his death, in the year 152 of the exile of Israel to Egypt. That's amazing right there, because it's telling us, the Bible does not tell us what year they were in exile and when the person died and stuff like that. This is amazing information that, because of this testament, I was able to figure out when Kohath was born and died, and when Amram was born and died, and when the exodus, or excuse me, when the exile into Egypt began. So it's amazing. All this material, even though it's fragments, we can use it to establish doctrines and prove things to be true. So he then says, upon him, and he sent and called to Uzziel, his youngest brother, and to him Miriam, his daughter, and said, you are 30 years old. And he gave a feast for 7 days and ate and drank during the feast. And then let's see here. Your fathers and my father Kohath let me go and to build and to obtain for them all they need from the land of Canaan until we ourselves build. And war broke out between Philistia and Egypt and was winning. Hold on. Let me read from a fuller manuscript because that one's very fragmentary. Here's one that says, Kohath there to stay and to dwell and to build the tombs of our fathers, many from the sons of my uncle together. A man, and about our work it was very much until the dead were buried. Rumor of war frightening those returning from here to the land of Egypt. Quickly, and they did not build the tombs of their fathers, and my father Kohath let me go, and to build and to obtain for them from the land of Canaan, until we build. And war broke out between Philistia and Egypt, and was winning. And they closed the border of Egypt, and it was not possible to. 41 years, and we could not. Between Egypt and Canaan and Philistia. And during all this, she was not. I myself did not take another woman. All that I will return to Egypt in peace, and I will see the face of my wife. In my vision, the vision of the dream, and behold, 2 were quarreling over me, and they said, and they entered into a great debate over me. There was something missing there. And I asked them, who are you that have received control and rule over me? And they replied to me, we have received control and we rule over all the sons of Adam. And they said to me, which of us do you choose to be ruled? I raised my eyes and saw that one of them had a dreadful appearance like a pestilence, and his clothing was colored and obscured by darkness. And I looked at the other, and behold, in his appearance, and his face was smiling, and he was covered with. And another fragment seems to indicate there is Melchizedek and Melchiresha. Resha is evil. So the king of righteousness, Melchizedek, and Melchiresha, which is king of evil. And let's see here. This other fragment, so remember I said, you are 30 years old, and he gave a feast for 7 days, and ate and drank during the feast and rejoiced. Then when the days of the feast were completed, he sent and called Aaron, his son. He was years old, and said to him, call my son Malachiah, from the house of above, called him. I, his father, from your word, and we will give you forever, and we will give you wisdom, and it will be added to you. You will be God, and an angel of God you will be called, and you will do it in this land, and a judge. And when your name, he's talking to Moses, he's giving prophecy to Moses right there. Moses was named Malachiah by Abraham. That excuse me, Amram. That was his original name. He was not named Moses originally. And there's in the Church Fathers, Clement of Alexandria refers to some of the secret books that some people had, and that in those secret books it says that Moses was given the name Melchi. Melchi. That's not a coincidence. Melchi, Malachiah, they're connected. So we have an ancient confirmation that Moses' original name was Malachiah. And it means angel or messenger of God. Or messenger of Yah or something like that. It's messenger. And so what's amazing about this is, so it gives us greater detail into chronology. Even though it's fragments, it's chronology. It helps a lot. It tells us about Moses' name, what his original name was, and it gives, it corresponds with the Book of Jubilees. The Book of Jubilees says some things which match only with this Amram book. How did Jubilees know? Because Jubilees must have been using the Testament of Amram as a source, because there's so many connections between Jubilees, some chapters in Jubilees, and what we just read. Jubilees talks about a war. Let me see. There's no other fragments to read. I mean, there's other fragments, but none that need to be read. So there's a whole full book of Testament of Amram, but it's mostly lost now because of the fragments of time, decay of time. But to conclude our study, I'm going to read the corresponding passage from Jubilees, and then we'll end it there. And I'm so glad you guys are with us, have spent time with us and studied with us today. So here's what Jubilees says. And he made them swear regarding his bones, for he knew that the Egyptians would not again bring forth and bury him in the land of Canaan. For Machamaron, king of Canaan, while dwelling in the land of Assyria, fought in the valley with the king of Egypt and slew him there and pursued after the Egyptians to the gates of Ermon. But he was not able to enter, for another, a new king, had become king of Egypt, and he was stronger than he. And he returned to the land of Canaan, and the gates of Egypt were closed, and none went out, and none came into Egypt. And Joseph died in the 46th Jubilee, in the 6th week, in the 2nd year, and they buried him in the land of Egypt, and all his brethren died after him. And the king of Egypt went forth to war with the king of Canaan in the 47th Jubilee, in the 2nd week, in the 2nd year, and the children of Israel brought forth all the bones of the children of Jacob, save the bones of Joseph, and they buried them in the field in the double cave in the mountain. And the most returned to Egypt, but a few of them remained in the mountains of Hebron, and Amram thy father remained with them. And the king of Canaan was victorious over the king of Egypt, and he closed the gates of Egypt. And he devised an evil device against the children of Israel, of afflicting them. And he said unto the people of Egypt, behold, the people of the children of Israel have increased and multiplied more than we. And then it goes through that story. And then Amram, he finally is able to come back. And then he teaches Moses writing and instruction in righteousness. It says, afterwards, when thou wast grown up, they brought thee unto the daughter of Pharaoh, and thou didst become her son, and Amram thy father taught thee writing. And after thou hadst completed 3 weeks, they brought thee into the royal court. So we see Jubilees corresponds with this testament of Amram. And there was one other thing I should have said, which I forgot to say, of testament of Amram also shows that the rabbinic tradition is full of stupid stuff that's not even true. It talks about how they have a tradition in the oral traditions of Amram divorcing his wife Jochebed and marrying another woman. But according to Amram, what he said, I did not take another wife, and I was longing to see my wife. So that's a complete contradiction of the rabbinic traditions. It's really amazing how, even though the fragments, it's only fragments, it still proves so much that their rabbinic stuff is completely false. So I hope you guys enjoyed this study, and I hope you guys come next week for our next one, whatever that will be about. Shalom, and Yah bless you all.